reggae festival, a touring reggae festival, a Jamaican reggae festival put on by Jamaicans. A lot of people never know that. So we want to go along in our history with you, and all the people them who listen to your foreign can write down what them are write down. We have a book here where it's a long time we should have really reviewed this book here, but not never done before the time. Reggae Sunsplash, 1978 to 1998 by Java Emmanuel I. Forward by yours truly, Mutabaruka. And what this book has done is to trace Reggae Sunsplash from its inception until the time when it stopped. And it's a very comprehensive book, I must say. It's the first I've actually seen a book written by a Jamaican with so much in-depth detail of a historical affair like Reggae Sunsplash. The man have everything in it, all how much the music charge when it start till when it end, which part it did I keep, the amount of artists were dip on it, how much time the artists them dip on it, the amount of disc jack them, the places where tour go. A very comprehensive book. I would recommend this book to any reggae enthusiast who want to just delve into a history, because you know, say, it's not every time black people write them one thing. And we give thanks that a brethren come forward. Years now, you know, I go and ask him to, if I'm not wrong, about 7-8 years, he have the book out there. Can you believe that? I don't know, it's what spirit that may come and say, no, we have to do it. But we'll tell him, like, from last year, so we don't go do it January, you know. And we never do it. But it's appropriate, given that this next festival here, which is the follow-up to Reggae Sunsplash, Reggae has been all over the lips of many people all over the world. And one wonders, when you go everywhere, people ask you, why I'm to Jamaica? Why I'm to Jamaica? Well, the follow-up to Reggae Sunsplash is Sunfest. And Sunfest have been around a very long time. As a matter of fact, it's from in the 90s, it come. And it's still here. I think it's 25 years now of Sunfest. We're going to find out from the producers and the ones them who originate the original Reggae Sunsplash. And then we figure out about what is it that we need to see in Sunfest, which most people know now who's listening to this program, and a lot of you never know about Reggae Sunsplash. So that is what we are going to work with tonight. This is The Cutting Edge on RFM. Before we forget, to all the people in New York City, especially Queens. Yes, it was wonderful, man. Yes, Farm of Jamaica present Lieutenant Stitchy. Who are you up, Lieutenant Stitchy? No? Lieutenant Stitchy. Who are you up, you know? Anybody who knows Lieutenant Stitchy, tell him some Mutabaruka, heal up Lieutenant Stitchy. Okay. And Sister Carol, I know that she could have still there in New York. Come on, you love Sister Carol. Ky-Mani Marley. No, me I tell you. Me have to tell the people them about that thing here, what happening in New York the other day. So we're up on stage and time ago, everybody here have to cut chart, them had cut chart them thing. The show was supposed to be done 8 o'clock. Not 8 o'clock in the morning, you know. 8 o'clock in the night. Different thing. In a from Jamaica. The show was supposed to be done 8 o'clock at about 11 past 8, you know, Ky-Mani Marley up on the stage. Two white men, you know, white police. Tell me, say, look here, cut that, lock that off. So we run up on the stage, everybody run up on the stage and I try to get Ky-Mani to come off on the stage, you know. You see, when Ky-Mani walk off on the stage, one of the white men them, police in a white shirt and black pants run up on the stage and hold up him finger and I say, one more, I tell you, the people them nearly drop down. thousands of people out there daily drop down, man. Them can't believe it. So the man run come on the stage, man, and Ky-Mani Marley hug him up, man. He hug up back Ky-Mani Marley, man, and Ky-Mani and sing One Love, man. The man. Me say the man get some applause. So it was a sight to see, because I've never seen that before, a foreign. I never seen that before in a foreign. The policeman tell you, must lock up, set, and then tell you, say, must play one more. But I mean, me come and hear policeman tell lock up, set already. Yes, it happened in a foreign too. For those of you who don't know, it happened in a foreign. You have to strict, them strict with it in a foreign. And I like Jamaica, where you can't get a man two beer, two policemen two beer, and them go and make it run. You understand? Them man, they charge you too. You have all venue, you know, you have indoor venues where if them tell the show supposed to be done 11, you know, you go over time, you know, you have to pay for your hour. Yes, so if it's like $6,000 you rent the place for, if you go over the time, you have to pay another $6,000, you know. Yeah, man, I saw them people that do them thing. Or the union people, them who are working there, when them tell you, say, 11 o'clock, and you know, don't show 11, you just see the place in the darkness. You better do some acapella thing inside it so without mic. Like, just lock off my yo. Them thing that happen in Jamaica, you tell a man, say, 11 o'clock, and 1 o'clock people just a come. But it was a sight to see when the policeman run upon the stage, man. Everybody feel good about it, man. The audience was ecstatic, man, when them say, the policeman say, one more. Yes, so that was something. But I say we have a wonderful time. Before I forget, you know, we meet some brethren in a Queens there. JR, them do a junior name. Them do cell phone. Them sell cell phone. We want to heal up the brethren who kind of treat me good. Anybody who know JR, when cell phone them cell phone them sell. Tell them MUTABARUKA yell them up and me and tell every Jamaican say, enter your New York and you want your phone click up right proper, go check him. As a matter of fact, him can set you up with all chip from Yasso. That's when you reach up there so it just work. Me know say advertisement, but me have to tell the people about this bridge there. So we're going to the place and go buy a couple phone from him. Yes. Couple phone, which is serious. And him fix me old phone where the brother the thief 2 years ago. Him fix it, put on new glass panels and everything. We feel good about that. But him ring round me and by scraping off a dozen off from me, because I buy a phone from him and my brethren tell me, say, Muta, and that you buy for the phone, me could I get that for $50. But I don't know, can't treat me good. I will know, say, next time when we are going to New York, we'll call him and say, Muta coming out, chip, Zim can. I will just work that. So anybody know him, tell him say MUTABARUKA yell him. With him little Indian friend inside at the store there when we never go to India yet. Cause I'm a Jamaican. Everybody inside the believe say come from India, but a Jamaican. Me I tell you, Jamaican people are easy, you know. A whole heap of Jamaican, they are Queens. So we want you look like Queens are the most Jamaican. We want you look all the people them. All the people them. Cause a long time we never go to New York. We dive road. We go through the airport and pass through, we never stop there. So we want you love all the people them who pay them $40 for come see MUTABARUKA when they have all the shoes. And that over them say. And that over them tell me, say, Muta, a $40 will pay you come up and see if you really have all the shoes, you know. So we want healing up. You understand? And we say give thanks to the brethren who take care away. And yeah, why you love Jessica? Why you love Jessica? I hope my people why you love, you know, but I don't know yellow program this, you know. I continue the journey. Cutting edge. Yo, we are serious, you know. You can't see that serious thing. We are talking about a fire in England there. May I tell you, that fire there, look away when we are looking on it. The fire look a weird rasta. No, serious. Me never see a fire like that in England yet. People all have dived through all them window with fire all up deep on them back. Yes. Fire in England. Them say about 12 people already them find dead. And it's supposed to go up to more. But it's a big fire that. A really big fire, man. How much story I? Me never tell not like that in England, Rasta. Believe you me, something go on, I don't know. Just like how we see a fire down town the other day. I mean, really, it's where I go on. Fire go on. Since me left here, last week and come back yesterday, I hear say 54 people get murdered. Rotten. Last week, me left here and come back this week, I hear say 54 people get murdered. That's why I'm afraid to go to Iraq, you know, or Syria. The bridge, we go to Turkey the other day, and the brother here, me say, me want to go up on the border, go to the refugee camp. Imagine me really want to go, and me say, yes. The only reason why me never go, you know, I threw me things that didn't near that which part of me the day. I me never really want to fly another hour or half hour after me come on and spend 14 hours for reach there, so. That's why me never go down there. But me would go down there. Because if me can live at Jamaica, me can't go to Syria, Rasta. Believe you me, and Iraq. Yeah, because if 50 odd people dead in a 1 week, murdered in a 1 week, and it never done because last night and the night before, we hear some more people gone again. May I tell you? Anyway, I don't know what is going to happen because these guys don't know what to do. Them don't know what to do. Understand? It can't fix, you know. Yeah, man, it can't fix, man. Don't feel over here. The thing can't fix. But will they want to fix it that way? How it's supposed to fix? Because many other countries have had worse problems than this when it come on to killing. And it fix. Yeah, woolly people, country. They didn't have worse problems than this. And them fix it. But you know, say they go fix. Maybe not with sleepy. I'm not with Mr. Keep me door open when I in a power. Mr. Keep me door open when I in a power. Well, I tell you, that's supposed to be the most embarrassing thing right now. I two things, Mr. Brother, they do where it's very, very embarrassing, you know. One, I'm going to a supermarket with a basket and hold up some food and I show the people them say, watch out now. Look how the food them expensive and dear. When I in a power, the next thing is that when I'm in a power, you can't leave your door them open. Now people, I put on more grill pan them gate, you know, and them house. What a, may I tell you. And them people that say them things there, you know, and them coming up power, you know, and it get worse. And there's no consequence. There's no consequence to these things, more than him just say it. Mr. Bunting, him asked for divine intervention because him couldn't do it. And this said people had all come down upon him because they must say, the thing get out of. And them can't control it. And imagine now the Minister of National Security asked for divine intervention. I mean, them don't know what to do. And now for them turn. And the thing worse, it was a ra. From January till now, are the worst in the history of Jamaica. So many people ever get murdered from January till now. The worst. First, so many people ever get murdered in Jamaica. And that government will tell you, say, every time the other party in a power, crime rate gone up. And if them was in power, you could have left your gate, your door open. And go in a supermarket, a whole up basket, and talk about, look how much we bread that's all, look how much we this that's all, poor people can't manage. I want him going to the same supermarket with a bigger basket or a little basket and see how much things him can buy with the same money where him the same that I buy things with. Ginal ship, the whole of them, Ginal. All them crave is power. The whole of them is Ginal. And the people them buy into it, I talk about say, when them in a power, you can't leave your door open. You know how much people want to leave them door open? You don't ever want to leave you don't ever want to open your window for breeze coming then out. Cause the breeze gonna carry some little bad vibration in your house. The other things that you know. Sometimes a bad vibration too. And them people there come on TV every day and chat them chat and people believe them depending on which party you belong to. Cause it's a party thing. If you listen to the radio, you realize it's a party thing at daytime. One man come and cuss the other party and the other one come and cuss the other party. There's no consciousness. Everybody has said, we're dealing with the people. It's the people we're dealing with, you know, sir. You don't see this government, and this government is the two government, them, you know. The two of them, PNP and GLP. PNP and GLP. But when I get in power, I will, I can't left, people will be able to left them door. I won't go to bed and dream them something. I won't go dream them thing there. And the former Minister of Agriculture is now the Minister of National Security and Just, National whatsoever he means. And him don't know what to do. What to do. Every day him look like he might sleep on the job. I don't know, him don't know what to do. The man them giddy. Giddy. But it can't solve, you know. It can't solve, man. And sometimes we recommend some things and them go out like them not listen, you know. But you see, if them go do what me say, it go sound like them a put power in my voice. And them no want it happen that way there. Them no want it happen that way there. Them no want to say, why, you know, it's Muta, when them get past stage, them say, and you know, Muta suggested that we did this and we went and did it and see, this and this is not happening again. Them no want to do that. Put power in a motor voice, you know, you're in a problem. So make them go and struggle with and make more people dead. The last thing now this brother talk about say, we must feel good because it's the murderer of them a killer of the murder, it's the bad man, the criminal them a killer of the criminal. We're supposed to feel good about that. We're supposed to feel good. Meanwhile, you hear that 4 people from one family get murdered. Meanwhile, I hear that. What a terrible thing. But the music is there. The music is there for really almost help the people them. Just feel like the rock not come down from them too heavy. Or feel like at least them can brace themselves. At least them can brace themselves. But the more I look upon where I go on, man, is the more I say, you see, politician Rasta, me I tell you, man, politician make out a different when them become politician. Because a normal people, them, you know. But you see, when them become politician, trust me, man, it's like when you have people that talk about them go to church and the spirit take them over, the spirit of the Lord and the name of the blood of Jesus. It come like you have something where when you become a politician, there's another spirit that is not of the Lord. I mean, I say it's of the devil neither. It's not of the Lord and it's not of the devil, but it's a spirit. Like what Roman Catholic them have seen for all different things. The Roman Catholic them have seen for teeth. Seeing for children, seeing for love, seeing for eat, seeing for this, seeing for that. And in a India, them have like millions of gods, and that god supposed to have a certain vibration that when you invoke that, even in Africa, when you invoke certain things, it take hold of you, and you become part of that thing. Well, I feel a politician. Unconsciously, when them declare themselves politician, them is a different type of people. Different. Them just different. Them not like me and you again. Them just totally different. Them have a different spirit, a different way for explain things, a different way for go about things. Them just different rasta. So me no know, me no know. Cause you have politicians who instigate murder. You have politicians who I tell you say they must employ extortionists to collect money. Your politician just have some weird, we don't know, Resta. No, I don't know at all. All I know say, this crime thing, have everybody upon them tipsy toes. Yes, have everybody upon them tipsy toes. Never in the history of Jamaica, apart from maybe earthquake. Well, earthquake never killed so much people neither in a 1 year, trust me. Not even the one when a Port Royal there. And then you have hurricane not killed so much people. A people that kill people, you know. Act of man. Oh gosh, man, it's a terrible thing. When you look at the paper and see sprawl across family of four murdered, you know, it's like, wow. I wonder if the Taliban, I wonder if the ISIL people them there, you know, the disguise a gunman. And them now use religion to project them wickedness. Because at some serious, at some weird kind of heart, you have to have some weird vibration to go in our house and see four people in the house, including children. And when you come out there, none of them are alive, you know. Yeah, man. It's a different kind of heart that Rasta. It's a different kind of art where you go for kill one man and kill all five, including children and women in the five. Different kind of art. And most of the youth them know have gun feel say the gun is more powerful than them penis. As a matter of fact, them are use the gun as them penis. Yes? Power lies in the gun, and if you look on the gun, you know, and you look on the bullet, you know, the bullet shaped like a penis. Yeah, the bullet shaped like a penis. And man, I say, boy, I'm a fire shot. Hi, boy, this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM. Yes, this is the Cutting Edge on IRFM, man. As we are talking about some man or politician, I suggest to the scammer, not the scammer, them, the extortionist, them collect government money. Ask them how much them usually get when them extort people and pay them that for collect government money. Maybe them should have just asked them also for collect people them who are thief light. JPS should have employed some extortionists for all the people them who are thief light, because the woman say 1 million Jamaican now pay light bill. That is 1/3 of the population. Can you imagine that? 1/3 of Jamaican population not paying light bill. So, me don't know. She a go with still, but maybe JPS can go to Spanish Town and employ somebody scammer them to collect the light bill from the people them who are thief the light. Just pay that, that's it. Only have two work, forget now, you know. People them in a Spanish Town. And if you can't get two jobs, maybe which I just ask, get some youth for go work for government and JPS and cut down the unemployment. I mean, me I follow the logics. I that me I do. Me I follow the logics. Me I follow the logics. And them I say it, you know, not me. Me just I see, me I follow the logics. I say, well, if the stationist them can collect money for government, maybe them can collect money for JPS too. Because a woman say it's 1/3, 1 million. Jamaica is 2.7 million, them say, call it 3 million, and is one third of Jamaica people not paying a light bill. So if one third of the population not paying a light bill, can you imagine if GPS would supposed to collect that light bill money? It would have benefit some people, and it would have benefit the extortionist them. The extortionist them would have two jobs with government, and then maybe some youth who live in school can go join with the extortionist them and work with the extortionist them to collect money for the government and for JPS and any other entity out there that need to collect money. You know, say we are getting mad. And not we still. Them are getting mad. Them are getting mad. Believe you me. It's desperation cause this thing, you know. Desperation. Yeah, them say a drowned man will have pastra. A drowned man will have pastra, but it's desperation. I go on to Jamaica. Cause we can't employ this scammer them too, you know. Yeah man, this camera them know how to draw money out of people account. Like the bank name. it's like the bank name, you know. And something should I talk about tomorrow though. We have sweeter things we have to deal with that though. You know what I mean? It's like tomorrow work with that. Right now we want to deal with this music. Yeah, what we play last week. I kinda love the music, you know. Me love this new car. Hey, boy, you know, all the ones that been in England who know, say, why that the fire there make you feel so weird, man. Make you feel weird. You see people that jump out a building with fire upon them back. Can't escape. Weird. And you know, I bet you Jamaicans involved in that in terms of living in another building there. And the whole of the place are burned down, you know. I want to follow to the fire. And the whole of the place are burned. People up there whole lamp and glass. I try lick the glass and come out and all them. And people ask them which floor them dip on. May I tell you? It's a weird thing. So you will say so now. We want to turn over the program to... All right. Where were they? We are turning over the program to the lady. All right. Jamaica Roots and Culture. Here goes.
Welcome to Jamaican Roots and Culture. I'm Pat Clark. Our language is one of the most important aspects of our culture. In Jamaica, Patois is often referred to as our mother tongue. It is a language which comes naturally to the majority of Jamaicans. It is an oral tradition and not generally a written language. There's no standard way to write it. How did this intriguing language evolve? Let's explore the origin. Creole languages are found all over the world on every continent. When two or more languages come into contact to form a new language, a Creole language is born. Some type of human upheaval that forces people to find a way to communicate without using their own languages stimulates the creation of Creole languages. In the case of Creole languages in Jamaica, the upheaval was the past history of slavery. Most Creole languages have their base in one language. In Jamaica, enslaved Africans were thrown into a situation where the only common means of communication was English, or at least broken English. Therefore, Jamaican Creole has a significant portion of its roots in English. However, some essential words which people could not find an English name for were taken from a variety of West African languages. From all indications, therefore, the development of the Jamaican Creole is linked to the history of the country's interaction with a variety of cultures and languages from many ethnic, linguistic, and social backgrounds. Aside from the Arawaks, the original inhabitants of Jamaica were all exiles or children of exiles. Over 90% of the 2.5 million people living in Jamaica today are descendants of enslaved people brought from Western Africa by the British. The local Jamaican language is a reflection of a history of contact with a variety of speakers, but the official language remains to be standard English. Jamaican history and the making of language are based on the experience of exile. In the 16th century, Spanish settlement began in Jamaica with the Arawaks as their first slave labor force. Within 100 years, very few Arawaks survived due to a deadly epidemic and genocide. The only evidence of the Arawak dialect in Jamaica today is a few words depicting certain place names, food, natural objects and events, for example, hurricanes. And the country name Jamaica is actually an Arawak word. It is possible that the first contact of the Arawaks and the Spaniards may have led to an early pidgin or bilingualism among the first generation of mixed blood. Throughout Spanish rule, the Arawaks had contact with Spanish colonists, Portuguese Christians, Jews, and Amerindians brought in as slaves from other parts of the Caribbean and West Africans. In 1655, the English attacked the Spanish colony, bringing with them new influences. The birth of population centers such as Port Royal, Passage Fort, and Kingston served as a mixing pot of many different speakers. Africans came to acquire forms of English because of the domination of white dialects. During the heyday of sugar between 1700 and 1834, increasing numbers of Africans were imported to work on the large plantations. Conflict of identity emerged in the 18th century when many Creole whites firmly identified with Jamaica and did not want to be called Englishmen. This is the period thought to be most responsible for the forming of Jamaican language, which we now call Jamaican Creole. Increases in written records of Jamaican Creole were seen during the abolitionist movement from 1770 to 1838. English continued to influence Jamaican Creole in the form of biblical language and prayer book language. The most influential speakers were immigrants from Africa and Europe. Kwa, Twi, Manding and Kru are among the variety of prominent African languages apparent in Jamaican history. Early modern English was brought to the Caribbean by sailors, soldiers, indentured servants, convicts, and settlers in the form of regional and non-standard dialects. Today, in Jamaica, Patois falls at one extreme of the language spectrum, while standard English lies at the other end of the spectrum. As a result of Patois not being an official language, a name for the Jamaican dialect has not been settled even to this day. Common names such as Jamaican Creole, Jamaican Patois, Black English, Broken English, and even Baby Talk or slang are all used to describe the Jamaican indigenous tongue. Linguists agree that East Indians, Spanish, and Arawaks have contributed somewhat to the vocabulary of the Jamaican dialect, but the majority of non-English terms, grammar, and phonology is African. And now to end the Jamaican roots and culture, here's our famous quotation from the Black diaspora. The black man who wants to turn his race white is as miserable as he who preaches hatred for whites. The words of Franz Fanon. For Jamaican Roots and Culture, I'm Pat Clark.
Yeah, that was lovely, man. And the language. A lot of us don't know that kind of history. And that is what Pat Clark bring, a kind of Jamaican roots history. One day, the teachers them going to have to call back for those programs to play it forward, because that is what you need in the school. A whole heap of them kind of history there. It's necessary in the schoolroom. We have to really make a turn around right now, you know, because the thing get away, Rasta. Yeah, man, the thing get away. And nobody know when I realize that they get it. Well, people realize they get away still, but it's like them don't know what to do. Yes, it stun everybody. Very important, the language. Okay, so we tell you, say we have this feature here, Reggae Sun Splash. 1978, Reggae Sun Splash to Sunfest. You know that Sunfest is now, Reggae Sun Splash was then. Little sister beside me, I should not know nothing about Reggae Sun Splash. You know about Sun Splash? You used to go at Sun Splash? You tell your baby in a crib, man. You're in a crib, a baby crib. Crib in a baby. All right, so we want to talk to Ronnie Burke. Ronnie Burke is one of the main man them who was part of that Genesis. Ronnie, how are you the man?
Yeah, man, I'm good, Mota. Good to hear you, man.
Why the first you come on the program, I believe you, man. I'm so glad to have you here, man.
Yeah, man, I'm glad to hear your program. You know, too.
All right. We want to document this program for future references because we have a book here. I know you must know of the book because today
yes,
I have
you. Yes, I know the book.
Yeah, Java Emmanuel, him do it about several years ago. We have him on the line at all. But we want...
Hey. Greetings.
Yeah.
Long time haven't spoken to you. Good to hear you.
Yeah. Java, you did it too?
Yeah, man. Greetings, Adi. Greetings, Mota. Greetings to the listeners, you know?
Yeah, and it's a long time we're supposed to do that program right now, but yeah. As we said, nothing ever done before the time. All right. Ronnie.
Yes, man.
Oh, I know about you. I know about Dan Green. I know about
Tony Johnson.
Tony Johnson, I think Wakelin did in the tour.
And John Wakelin.
Is the 4 hour started? Oh, God. Explain to Jamaican people. What caused a lot of some young people to come up with this thing?
Well, you know, I was a life insurance man for about nearly 10 years. But my heart is always in the music. And so I kind of just jumped out of the music thing. And went with a school friend of mine named Mike Johnson, and we started a company called Micron Music Limited. And we just did Jamaican music. We weren't interested in any distribution of anything, you know, anything but Jamaican music. And for a while it did pretty well, you know. We actually distributed for Bob Marley the Natural album. And that was like a magnet for a lot of the other major artists. So I had a pretty good association with practically all of the name artists of the day. Mm-hmm. But due to circumstances, we went out of business. And just then, Tony Johnson returned to Jamaica after about 17 years in America, putting on a school in Los Angeles and really distinguished himself when he was brought back to Jamaica by the UDC as an urban planner. But if you think I love reggae music, you check Tony. Tony was a fanatic. And at the same time, Dan Green came back from New York after about 10 years in New York. And, Tony introduced me to Dan, and I introduced him to John because we were just hanging out on a daily basis, and always the subject was reggae music. And those guys were very upset. I mean, Tony used to rant and rave, you know, boy, I could go to reggae concerts in LA any Friday and Saturday night, and I come home to Jamaica to the home of reggae, and I can't find a concert. And he was really upset, and the same with Don. And so we used to sit around and bounce this subject around and talk about, you know, we thought that, you know, Jamaica was really wasting a major, major cultural resource. And both guys who lived in America were insistent that we don't seem to understand that this could be a major tourist attraction. So we used to bounce it around. And then along came a lady named Burl Francis. Well, Burl was working at the UDC at the same time with Tony. And then she left and she started to work with Peter Martin Associates. And Peter Martin was the Jamaica Tourist Board PR agency in the summer. I mean, all the hotels used to just square up.
Empty.
Refurbished, they have staff. and their big headache was, how can you attract people to Jamaica in the summer? And they came up with the idea that, well, look, my son was doing this, what they call a single week during the summer, which was very successful. It was a, you know, targeting youngsters to come down to a beach.
Oh, like a spring break. Fun. Like a spring break thing.
And right. And then they thought, well, maybe we could do the same thing in Jamaica. And they were looking for some promoters who would perhaps take on a song program of music or musical events. And she went to the right person. She went to her friend, Tony.
Tony Johnson.
And Tony rounded us up.
That's Tony Johnson.
That's correct.
Yeah. And what year this was? What year this was? What year this was?
1977.
Okay.
And Bell encouraged us to put a program together and make a presentation to the church. And so we spent days and nights at Tony's house designing this program, you know, or we put together a reggae festival. People thought we were crazy, you know, Muta.
Of course.
You guys are crazy.
Mm.
You think tourists are going to come to Jamaica for Jamaica music, and boy, Tony, of all of us, was very, very stubborn and insistent, and Burl encouraged us. And so, finally, we made a presentation to the tourist board. We came up with an 8-day event.
Mm.
You know, we had two beach parties, and we had a jazz night for reggae jazz, and we had four major nights of reggae concerts.
Yes.
And we made this presentation to the tourist board. And boy, it took a lot of fighting. It took a lot of persuasion. They were very skeptical. I mean, Bell was always with us, you know. And you know who was a big help in it? Was Barbara Leader.
Okay.
Barbara was the deputy director of tourism.
Tourism, yes.
And Desmond was the director, and he was very pessimistic about the whole thing. But we fought and fought and fought, and Bell had convinced Peter Martin, and so finally they said, okay, let's give it a go. So that we sat down trying to find a name for this thing, and Dan came up with this. Well, we have to capture a name that give us beach and give us music, yeah, and you know, all the elements that you make us offer. And finally Bell came up with a name, Sunsplash.
Yes.
And everybody agreed, boy, we love that name. So we named our program Reggae Sunsplash. And of course, we decided to give it a chance. Mm. So, off we went, Muta. I mean, there was no such thing as a reggae music event, festival, anywhere in the world at the time.
Yes.
And as I said, people thought we were crazy in family.
Yes.
Thought we were crazy, but that was the beginning, you know.
Okay, all right, so.
And we fought with it.
Yeah, all right, wait, hold on. You said Sunsplash. So who had the reggae on it? Or it just came automatically?
Well, it was always going to be reggae something.
Okay, you know?
And so we threw the name around, and Dan came close with, you know, we need to keep the beach element in it and the music element in it. And finally, Sunsplash.
Yes.
That's the name. Okay. And we just looked at each other and said, yes. And you know, at that time, because we had an Austrian artist, graphic artist, named Werner Steisman.
Yes.
Was in his 60s at the time. And he said to Werner, look, we need a symbol.
Yes.
We need some kind of design. And that man, within about 2 hours, came up with what we now call the reggae man.
The dread with the guitar.
That's correct.
All right. Well, I'm going to come forward to this. This is the cutting edge. We're exploring the first reggae festival leading up to Sumfest. Ronnie.
Yeah, man, I'm right here.
Ah, yes. Yeah, we are talking about the beginning, the genesis of this thing. So we reach a point where you say now it named Reggae Sunsplash.
Yes.
And
yes.
The tourist board, even though reluctantly, but all on pan it and go with it.
Yes, and we went to Montego Bay, and you know, you can imagine doing an event like a Reggae Sunsplash, a full week of events. You know, you got to do it before internet.
Yes.
You got to do it before cell phone.
Yes.
Jamaica had no stage. We had no
equipment
PA that could do big outside events. We had no concert lighting. So we just had to make do, you know what I mean? We had a lot of help from people who just caught on to the idea and just jumped in along with us. I mean, we had a lot of fight too, you know.
Yes, can I imagine?
But we had a small army of people, and we got excellent support from the artists. Because really, until the artists had the vision, the artists could caught on to the vision before most people.
Mm.
And we had a full turnout, everybody in Eclipse. And somehow we got together and we delivered our full week of weather. We didn't really get the kind of tourist support that...
Yeah, but the Jamaican tourist... That was 78, no, not 77.
78, that was 78, yeah.
Okay.
We didn't really get the kind of tourist turnout that we anticipated. And so, financially, it was kind of a disaster, you know?
Yeah.
Put up all our assets, money in.
Wow.
Bank check with the card, man.
But
you know, the second year now, this is really interesting now, because we had delivered the thing. We got some cynical reviews from the local press. We got good reviews from a few overseas publications. And then one day I went up to Tufcom, because, you know, as I said, we used to distribute Nakazet for Bob. One evening I went up to Tufcom, and he was sitting on that tree, struggling away, and he said, come here, man. Come here, let me talk to you. So I went over and he said to me, I see you have a poster that says you have the biggest reggae festival in the history of the world, because that's what they really had, you know?
Yeah.
I said, yes. He said, well, that's a lie. I said, well, Bob, why is it a lie? He said, because I am not on it.
He wanted it.
So I said, Bob, look, you're the first person. I went to Don Taylor before I went to anybody else. Mm. And Don would have nothing to do. He said, no, you go tell Don Taylor. I said, me, Bob Marley, go and do it.
Yes.
And that was...
The next year.
That was magic.
The next year.
That was magic. That was 79.
I can just say, if you remember, I want to just read out something from Java Emmanuel book, yeah? Reggae Sunsplash 1978, Jared Park. Friday, which it happened in June, Billy Vernon and the Celestials, Ras Michael and the Sons of Negus, Light Parks and We the People Band, Dennis Brown, U-Ride, Jacob Miller and the Inner Circle Band, admission reserve seats. Listen to this now, people. Admission reserve seat, $8. Pan the field, $5. Bleachers, $3. Sunday, June 24th, Cornwall Beach, Montego Bay, Sugar Belly, Billy Vernon and the Celestials, admission $5. Part 2, Saturday, June. All right, listen to this now. Business Corporation of Love, Joe Higgs, Light Parks and We the People Band, the Eptones, Jimmy Cliff and Oneness Band, admission reserve seat $10. That is reserve seat. That is like when they would have talked about no more VIP seat. That's when they would have said VIP. You are laugh when I didn't hear about $25 for Red Star, like Pop Dog. All right. Sunday, June the 25th, Jared Park. All right, family evening of various artists from the Western Jamaica Festival competition, plus the Shades Dance Group, Fab Five, Byron Lee and the Dragonaires, the Blues Busters. Admission reserve seat $5. Meet the Dragon single jumper Monday, Casamantico, Farmer Jump Up Festival featuring Barrel and the Dragonaires and the Blues Busters. And it goes on admission $5. Sunsplash Beach Party Tuesday, June the 27th. And that was Barrel and the Dragonaires again, admission $5. That was the first Sunsplash. That was the lineup for the first Sunsplash. $5 for VIP section. you look for that, it's lucky, man. $5 now, people don't even look for the $5 silver coin again. Believe you me. All right, so the next year, you say, Bob Marley, same one, accompany it, and that was Bob Marley upon it the next year.
Yeah, man, Bob Marley and Third World were the outstanding acts for that year. And I tell you something, when the announcement of Bob Marley came out, that is when Manchester City hotels went crazy.
Okay.
Because all of a sudden they had more reservations than they could handle.
Man.
You should have seen, I mean, they were caught flat-footed. Motor, we had to use our vehicles and drive hotel managers to people's gates, to the workers, to tell them to come back to work quick, and they had to be cleaning out room and painting all through the night, and the place was sold out totally. The airlines were sold out. People were sleeping on the ground in the Miami airport trying to get a flight into Jamaica. McGill was sold out. Salmat was sold out. Right up the runway base.
Sold out.
It was madness.
But I want to tell you, say, what I mentioned a while ago was 5 days, no, it's 8 days, it lasts, wow.
That was 8 days. And
yeah, but what I'm saying, that the first one, what I just mentioned a while ago, was 5 days. I never mentioned the last 3 days. The last three of that, Harold Butler, Monty Alexander, Eat Incorporated, the Revolutionaries, Alti and Dana, Culture, Barry Salmon, Toots and the Metals. Then the last day at Burning Spear, Third World, the Wailing Souls, Soul Syndicate Band, Bob Andy. That was the last day of the first festival. Yeah, so you have to
great lineup. A great lineup, eh?
Yeah, how you mean, man? Always. So 1978 now, it's step up now. Bob Marley say him I'll come do it. And whole place sold out.
Everywhere was sold out. There was chaos, madness.
Yes.
Madness in the place. You know? And that is when Jamaica really realized what it is that we had.
Yes.
That's when we really realized.
And all right.
Our music.
Dan, you depend the radio, Dan? Dan.
Yeah?
You're there, what, man?
Yeah, man. Hey, Dan. I listen.
Hey, Dan, you know, how you doing, brother?
All right. Dan.
Yeah,
I want to find out, you see, the company with Synergy. Oh, I don't know the meaning of Synergy, but it sounds like such a beautiful name for a group of brethren come together and call a thing named Synergy. How the name the combo?
Well, the name that I was introduced to by Tony and Ban, the meaning of Synergy was the sum is more than the whole is more than the sum of the parts. And if you can, that is really the meaning of Synergy. And at that time, nobody understood this word. We were called Synergy, Synergy, all kind of names. Now I have to laugh because everywhere I turn, I see Synergy this and Synergy that. But it was a name that Don and Tony had come up with. I don't know where they got it from, but they had already formed a company called Synergy to do other things. And when we came up with the Sunsplash idea, Don and Tony decided that they would use the name for the music event, Synergy Productions. So you need to ask Don where he got that name from.
Yeah.
Don there?
Yeah, may I hear you, yes. Ronnie?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, man, you did say something, but the thing cut out a while ago.
Oh, okay. No, that's a name I got from Tony and Don.
Okay.
The word Synergy is something that they introduced.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where the name started out.
Yeah.
At the time, it was a new name.
It's a real word,
and
man.
The meaning of it was that the whole was more than the sum of its parts.
Yes, yes.
In other words, it was bigger than the four of us together.
Yes.
You know? And it's a name that they had for a company that they had formed before they met me. Before I met Don anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I knew Tony for a long time.
Okay.
But if Don is on the line, man, I can explain.
All right, I'll go for our next ad business and come forward. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I hope you have Dan then, you know, Dan.
Yes, sir. How are you doing? Good evening to your radio listeners.
Yes.
I'm happy that I'm connected now.
Of course, definitely. Because we couldn't talk about this and not talk to you, you know. Because the two of know visibly, you know, the other ones, they move in. Yeah, everybody is gone, you know.
Survivors, right, yes.
All right, Dan Green, I'm going to ask about the word synergy. And yes. Ronnie, I said we should talk to you about it.
Well, that was easy, you know. You see, Tony and I actually had formed a company prior to Synergy Sunsplash.
Mm-hmm.
We had formed a company. It was basically getting together because Tony had come from overseas. I had come from overseas after studying. We both came back to Jamaica when everybody was going in the opposite direction. Everybody was leaving Jamaica during the late 70s. Especially after Michael Marley.
The Cuba thing.
But five flights a day or something
Yes.
Those who want to leave, let them leave.
Yes.
So many people are going the other way. And Tony and I, we came back. I did not know Tony previously, but we met in Jamaica and we found that we were basically thinking the same thing. We wanted to come back to Jamaica to contribute to Jamaica. So many things were happening. Everybody was talking about the light going out in Jamaica because of the whole socialism, capitalism schism that was going on at that time.
Mm-hmm.
To answer your question, Tony and I, when we got together as four people, myself, Tony, Ronnie and John, we said we wanted to form a company and let's think of a name. And Tony was the one that came up with Synergy. And we did have some little doubts about it. How would the people accept Synergy? It sounded like sin, eh? But Synergy is a powerful word. And it's all about togetherness.
Yes.
It states that the sum of the individual parts is not as great as
connected.
The sum of the combined parts.
Yes.
So basically, with synergy, you can get a situation where 2 + 2 could be equal to 5. When everybody is working together, they can produce more. Right. So that was basically how it came about.
All right, Dan.
Yes, sir.
The dictionary meaning say the interaction or cooperation of two or more organizations, substance or other agents to produce a combined effect greater than the sum of their separate effects.
So it's part, exactly.
Yeah, so everybody coming together differently, but coming together to make one synergy, to make the synergy.
Yes. And it really works, you know, really works.
I mean, I see that it developed.
It was so profound. I think many youngsters, many young entrepreneurs saw what we were doing and they saw it working, and I think it helped to inspire a lot of people. And as you know, Sunsplash in itself
can I tell you something now? Cause I used to live in them days, I used to live in Montego Bay. We up in the hills, a place named Potosi. And the first year I hear about this reggae festival, I said, "Chum, I left my bush for going to reggae festival in the Rasta." But you know, the next year when I hear, say, "Bob Marley, they put it." Trust me, man. We reach down at somebody, Jared Park, like pee pee, clack, clack. Just to see when Bob Marley walk going on there. It's the same your third world in the planet with CV.
Third world.
Exactly. And CV Wanda.
Yeah.
Came when Bob died in 81.
Yeah, we're gonna look on it. We're gonna see that book. Yeah, but no, man, I went there and I totally enjoyed it. I never go back at one until I perform on it. the next one I go, I was at the stage itself. But all right, so the program developed to become years, and then we see say on a move it and tour with it, because I was on one of the tour them with it to Japan and America. Decide that you go and take a reggae festival on the road, because that seemed like an Atlas Hercules thinking to take a reggae festival and carry on the road. How come about that now? Because one that I never expect, say, all right, the show stays in a Jamaica is a reggae festival. Why wouldn't you want to take it on the road now and tour with it? And it did, you did tour with it for years and tour with it. So how that start, how that come out? Because I've never heard of another reggae festival tour in America.
Well, what happened is that in about 1984, things got so tight to this, so dread that Tony decided to go back to Los Angeles. He was still with Sunsplash, but he had to take his family back up to Los Angeles because, the kids have got to the stage where college was beckoning and, funds were very tight, and Tony went back up. But he never rested, He started, that is how the tour started, because he went up there and started to build
from the air. And got some backing.
Yeah. And then Dan now had some Japanese connections. And that is how we got to Japan.
Yes.
We got to Japan through Dan and his connections there. Mm-hmm. And then, Europe was a natural. We did two massive events in London with Capital Radio.
Yes, I remember that.
Crystal Park. We sold out Crystal Park, 25,000 people each. And then the offshoot to Europe was a natural from there,
Yes. And but don't forget, in that time, there was no other festival.
Clapham Common Park.
Yes.
Which was 1987. Clapham Common Park, that festival in 1987, I think, might actually hold a record in terms of attendance. We had approximately 300,000 people in Clapham Common Park,
And that was a police estimate.
Yes. I mean, it literally shut down London.
Yes,
it was the largest crowd.
They've ever seen part of festival.
It was so big that the British authority never allowed us to come back.
The trains, everything came to a dead halt because of so many people. Of course, for those people who are listening, it was a free concert, We never got paid anything at the gates.
Yeah.
It was free.
But this was reggae. At that time, it was reggae. Which is make a difference.
Yes.
Even if it's not free thing, but if you have reggae in a that, space.
Yes. Freddie McGregor was the main artist.
Yeah, Freddie.
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
Yes. Freddie, Max the Priest was there also. Yes. So really a great event.
All right.
Crystal Palace was really good because we got Prince Buster. We were instrumental in putting his catalyze together.
Yes.
Which they had not been together for a very, very long time.
Yes.
And it was a classic event.
Yeah. All right.
Yes.
In terms of festival now, we see, all right, one of the things that I hear, and Java will tell you too, that when you mention Sunsplash now, the first thing come to mind is Europe. Because a lot of these, what them call millenniums now, and a lot of youth now, them know about Sunsplash. Mm-hmm. In Europe, them never know, say, I see one of the reasons why we really want to do this program at all is to make people know, say, watch out, the name Sunsplash never come from Rotterdam or Germany. I don't hear so it come from.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the things they were related to reggae, I hear so it come from. And we have to make the people them know, say, Sunsplash, some of the man them who originated, I hear so them there, them still alive, and it's just so it go. We have to know that, We can't make it
it's at that time, for us to register the name across the world was way beyond our means. I think the quotation for registration was over $600,000. So we couldn't afford to legally registered the name across the world. So other people took it up, you know. Every time took it up. And I'm happy to hear you spread the word that, you know, it's a Jamaican event. It's a Jamaican name, yes. Born and bred right here.
In a Jamaica, yes. All right. Why is... people, in a them time, the sound used to go around and say, why them brother they know buy a place, have it a permanent place, instead of carry it around the eye, carry it around the place, Jared Park, we about Bob Marley Center, you know, one time Ronnie Williams Center was part of that, Dover, I remember I performed at Dover, where the place out of Portmore, Jam World.
Yeah,
all right, where did that go around? Yeah. What was... you know, you have an intention to get a permanent place for yourself, or just something was out of reach?
Well, it was just out of our reach financially, to be honest with you, you know?
We
had really outgrown Jared Park. We were putting on a dance hall night 25,000 people in Jared Park, and it was getting really dangerous. Mm. The irony of it, you know, Muta, is that the Bob Marley Center wasn't built for us, you know, it was built for some foreign promoters who brought on an event called
I remember, man. Garcia and all them people, that's Peter Davis.
Right.
Peter Tosh, right. Remember, man? Yes. So, I want to get that now, because if that was built that way there, and then want to get in the twilight and draw 40,000 people in there, I remember. I mean, Shabba Ranks, come on, pan, in a helicopter, come down, pan, that is the most memorable time.
Well, you know, what happened is that after the World Music Festival, which was supposed to be an annual event, they just walked away and left it. And it was abandoned. The whole place was stripped of all its assets. It was overgrown with bush and things. And we wanted to use it. And the government said, well, you can use it at your own expense. So we had to take what resources we had and we totally rebuild the Bob Marley Center. Charles Campbell, who was, became one of our partners and directors.
Yes.
I mean, put his life into that place, you know.
Yes.
To completely replace all the electricals, all the fences, the installed 50-odd toilets. We just rebuilt the place.
Yeah, I remember. You know, at
an expense.
Yeah. And I remember.
And there was a recurring problem. The recurring problem was that at the end of the staging of each festival, you know, we had to tear down everything.
Pull down everything.
And then we rebuild it the following year.
Yes,
and that was a recurring
expense,
cost that had to really put a lot of financial strain on the project.
All right, so tell me, why don't we reach a Kingston now? Ronnie Williams Center, Jam World.
Ronnie Williams Center came about because in the 1980 election, because there was so much murder. Remember Jamaica had about 800 murders in 1980, you know.
We
never had anything like that before.
Yeah.
And the American and the English governments put travel restrictions on their people. Said, Jamaica, forget about Jamaica. Jamaica is erupting, you know.
Yeah.
So there's no point going back to Montego because there are no tourists.
Yes. All right, so why...
So, just to keep the thing going, I went to Randy Williams Center.
All right, so why Chukka Cove?
Mm-hmm.
Why Chukka Cove? Can I remember performing at Chukka Cove? And where them the race players Dover.
Well, Chukka Cove came after.
Yes.
After Synergy per se.
Yes.
You know, had sort of disbanded. Everybody went different ways.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the introduction of the former director of the tourist board, which was
but before we get there, you know, we have to remember, you know, that after we spent 6 years motor rebuilding the Bob Marley Center from nothing to what you knew it as, the government decided that it was ideal for real estate development, and they sold it to a developer to build houses and threw us off of it.
You see, Seawin was the old lad, Seawin. Isn't that serious? The oldest, because the hotel was long there. Yeah.
And then they promised to fix up Catherine Hall and move us from from the Bob Marley Center to Catching Hall. And I just never got Catching Hall ready, and we had nowhere to go.
And Catching Hall couldn't work for the time, people.
No, where to go. Catching Hall, where Sunfest is now.
Yeah.
That was promised to us.
Mm.
And it was supposed to be a smooth transition by the UDC from the Bob Marley Center to Catching Hall. But when, and it took they gave us two years notice.
Mm.
But they never touched the place. I mean, and when the time came now for us to move over to Catching Hall, it just wasn't ready.
Okay.
It just couldn't. So we had nowhere to go. We were kind of lost. And that's when we said, you know what? If the government doesn't care about our event and tourism, then let's abandon tourism and survive. And that's when we got to Jamworld.
Okay. And that night, yeah, I remember all you massacre did upon it.
That's right.
Man of the Bongo. Them African artists there, you know, I mean, really. All right. So, make we, can we have a movie and it's 12 o'clock. Tell me something now. Sunfest. We see Sunfest come, like a half shoot of Sunsplash. And you see them transfer authority from one organization to the next. As ones who pioneer the thing, you have any advice, or you just no bother with no advice? Where you could have look out for a pitfall? What you think is a pitfall if you go on a certain trend, this will happen or that will happen? Because maybe a man can't sit, you know, you have to deal with another man experience. So what kind of experience you did see that you feel like you could have tell Joe about and say, look at Joe, this is that and this is that, don't do that and don't do that?
Well, I don't know, that may have a different view. My view, you know, Uta, is that the whole reggae scene has changed a bit, you know. We were determined to keep our event as a reggae event.
Yes.
When Sunfest came in, after a while, they started to go into the hip hop business for the mega artists, you know.
I
don't know what the experience was. Maybe they felt that, you know, the
young people,
the star lineup was not what it used to be nowadays, they couldn't pull the crowds because the truth is dancehall outnumbered everybody else.
Yeah.
Even for us.
But I was talking to Joe last year upon his program, and him same way, him want to bring it back as a strictly reggae dancehall festival. And we see last year was one of the biggest crowd them get with just reggae dancehall. And I think him will do about the same thing again. So here's this man come now and say, look here, we want to carry it back to the idea of reggae. And since we now infuse dancehall, reggae and dancehall, that is what him say. You know, that is what I'm seeing to do, you know. So I don't know if there's anything that, I mean.
Well, I don't know. I think that what your problem needs to do is a good mix of the young and the old, because we do have some nice rising young artists.
Yes.
You have to be careful that dancehall don't wipe out reggae.
Yes.
You know? So you have to keep a balance, I think, you know. There's some real promising
reggae artists.
I guess coming from you'd call them the leader of that new set.
Yeah.
But there are still veteran artists out there like Warrington Levy's and Freddie McGregor who still have it, you know. So I think a mix.
Yeah.
I mean, no two ways about it. Dancehall is going to bring the biggest crowd.
Definitely.
Don't care what you do. And but I like the idea that Joe have of keeping it as Jamaican
pure as possible. Yes.
I love that part about it. Yeah. I love that part about it. You know, and I think Joe has the resources. I think he can rebuild the whole tourist side of it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I haven't been there for a while. I've never been to one of those events, but I used to go to Sunfest every now and again.
Well, last year was the first Joe do it.
Right. Mm. So, I don't know much about it. I know that he had a very big dance hall night.
Yeah, but maybe after tonight, you and Dan will have a job.
I, I don't know about that. I'm kind of retired, Booster.
Ready? You can't retire, man. A young boy like you talk about retirement. What are you talking about, man? Young boy like you talk about you retire. Retire where?
Well, Booster, it's been a long, hard journey.
We know, but if the money is right, you get young again, man. What are you talking about?
It's tough. And, you know, I don't think so.
And that is the cry out there now. What is really happening in Jamaica? Why is it that the thing get away so? And it's because the steerers who supposed to steer it is not steering. You know, them just leave it in there for us.
The motor.
Yes,
motor.
Hello?
I don't know, so my band got cut out.
Anyway, Dan, we have to say give thanks. Anyway, Ronnie, give thanks, you know. Give thanks to the link. You talk for both.
It's been a pleasure, man. It's been always a pleasure, man. And thank you for your contribution to Sunsplash.
You could forget
style at Sunsplash.
May I tell you, $25. My style, what do I want to tell you, now? This book here show that me and Dennis Brown appear upon Sunsplash more than every other artist.
That's true.
A 12 time I appear upon it.
That's true. And I tell you something else. When you put a stall on the ground, that attracted a whole lot of other people to come in and do the same thing.
May I tell you, man? It was wonderful. What? Ronnie gone? Anyway, we don't say we are going to edit still, so I don't know. Ronnie Burke, we've been talking to the founders of Reggae Sunsplash. Ronnie Burke, Dan Green, Dan Wicklin, which passed away, and my brethren Tony Johnson. So we reach a Sunfest. We're in the mood at Sunfest now. That's why I personally will continuously tell the people them to go out and support Sunfest. Go support Sunfest. Because we know what Sunsplash do for Jamaica and do for the music internationally. And we need to continue that tradition, government or no government. Can you hear Ronnie say? And we all agree. I don't really think these governments and these politicians understand the level of which the music contribute to the movement of, where I say, Jah people. Believe you me. Get away, and plus the style them now, you have 3 nights in the party where we used to rent style at $25. As a matter of fact, I tell you one thing. The first time I performed on Sunsplash, and that time I have 5 musicians. And manager. You know what I'm saying? 2,000 Jamaican dollars. And I have 5 musicians and a manager. And the manager draw 5-10%. That's a $200 she took out of my money before me start to pay the musician them and take a money for myself. I mean, I will tell you how much a musician them get. Because nowadays, that even per day. You can't go up on a music and get Muta, who you talk about? Who you get that for per day? That you can't even get a man. You think a man could have given me the money then now? But at different times, the money gone away differently. You know, see it? In all them days, as a matter of fact, you know, the US dollar did less than the Jamaican dollar. Yes, I remember when the US dollar and Jamaican dollar was like 8 US, I think. Cause when we used to go and Negula sell Tom, $8 me used to sell the Tom them for. When we used to need Tom and sell a Negula, $8 me used to sell the Tom them for. Where was that? The way things change, man. It's unbelievable how things change. Okay. So I want to go to part 2 of this program now. Reggae Sunsplash 1978 to 1998 by Java Emmanuel I. Yale Virgin.
Yeah,
right. Yes, okay. All right. This book has been out there. If you have, how long now the book come out, Bridget? Remind
me. Probably about 9 years now or something like
nine
that.
9 years?
Yeah.
Right, take it out there long. You know, say, yeah. You know, say enough you're going to sell now, though. You know, say you have to go print them back.
Well, enough, I tell you, Mota, I did the, everything myself. I did the photography.
No, yeah, me remember when you used to struggle with it. Oh, you get to ask me for write the forward to this book. I mean, if you remember, you know. I read it and I wonder if I mean really did write it.
Well, Muta, you know, it's over 25 years I did an interview with you when I was in America.
In Philadelphia?
Yeah, 2 hour long interview.
Wow.
And that was probably, I don't know, the first, second, or third time traveling out of Jamaica on music.
Yeah.
But it was the early years when you just started. You know?
Yeah, man, I remember. Mm.
You know? And we did that interview and 2 hours, and it's even very consistent with now and what you represent. And
then from the days, from the early 80s.
Yeah. So having that background and that association, you know, I said, well, you know, it was just a connection.
Yeah.
Check motor for the firewood, you know.
All right. Explain to me how you go about a book like this, like a chronology. This is now tracing the thing in detail, because in the contents you have Sunsplash venues, all the venues where Sunsplash keep, and then you have Reggae Sunsplash, the years them when it keep, and the artists them when they depend during the years, and then you have the admission fee. We just mentioned the admission fee, $5 for the first Sunsplash. Unbelievable, don't it?
Yes, really, it shows where we start, where we're coming from.
Somebody will call me and tell me, Muta, a $500, you mean, man, you don't mean $5. Well, a $5. It's unbelievable.
$5.
Yeah, and then you have now the frequency of the artist them pan the show. That means how much time an artist go pan the show in the period of time when Sunsplash lasts. And you have the artist them on the pan. How you go about that? I mean,
actually, I've been told that it's two books in one.
Yeah. But well, see something that you never mentioned, though. Come in the depot, one of the Japan splash them.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that's my name there. Yeah, me and
It's over 7 years of research, on and off, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean?
Me and Shinehead, I think, and I don't remember Shinehead, I think Freddie McGregor, I don't remember who. And Desi them, with the power of the Sunsplash them. And then me, Peter Metro, all right, I got it. Me, Peter Metro, Chalice, and Freddie McGregor. I don't want to leave out nobody. Me, Peter Metro, Chalice, Freddie McGregor, the depend on America, all American tour, like every state, right up to Canada.
Actually, you know, I didn't do the American tour. Yeah. I didn't touch the American tour, coming to think of it. So much information.
Yeah, but all you gather the information, where you go get the information? Tell me.
Actually, we go to the library, you know, and the Institute of Jamaica, gather pull all the greeners and stars and, you know, information from that. But first, I must say, actually, all the concept of the book came about is that I was working on the radio in Philadelphia, and I used to come down to the festival, and I had started a newspaper too in Philadelphia. So I was taking pictures, I was busy taking pictures. And I remember the time sometimes when Sunsplash had a long break, I would end up sleeping underneath the stairs with my camera bag like my pillow. And it was like working right around the clock taking pictures. So having said that, no, having all these pictures on Sunsplash, I needed to do something with the pictures. And from thinking about having these pictures, I wanted to publish them. I decided, okay, I will put it to a book. And that's where the whole idea now to cover Sunsplash, from having the pictures. And then I decided to say, well, we need to document ourselves, because oftentimes people abroad come and document us.
Well, Bridget, I want to tell you, that is really the part of it with Sweet Me More Than All. That is a Jamaican Rasta document, Swiggy Sunsplash. I don't know another book where cover Reggae Sunsplash like this book. And I really want to say give thanks. Because many times we complain, you know. Or white people come here so and I write this and I write that. And then when we look at it, we say, hey, you know, so say the boy I tell lie, I foolish my talk. This book, without any apology, is like Ronnie Burke, there. Because I have an interview with him inside, so. And him is part of the original part of them who started. So it get passed, it passed.
Yeah, and so did interview with Baiji because it was important in terms of
I have DJ Panorita at them time there.
Yeah, and Baiji was one of the most one of the MC that occupied the stage at Sunsplash the most,
But you all document all the DJ them, the MC them, and the document all the MC them with the company show.
Female and me. MC them.
And Tommy Kwan too was one very popular.
And also had an interview with Tommy Kwan, and he's in the book and the pictures and things like that, you know. And I find Bergy interview was interesting because when I speak him about the dancehall and whether he would the breakout at the dancehall, and his reply was that the dancehall wasn't getting a play on the radio and he was trying to bring it on the radio, and then after a while it got out of control and couldn't control it, and certain slackness and certain things came into play.
I remember one Sunsplash yellow man sword him on the stage at some serious terrible things yellow man say. I think I in a Jared Park too, you know. I don't know if you did there.
Well, you know, I was living in the state.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, I tell you, my yellow man, angry my weird. I mean, call all him name on the stage, you know. I tell you, it was something else, man. But that yellow man, it just arise up. And people never hear that blatant, vulgarity come out of this small on the stage that way there. You know, it's like this is like a new thing on a reggae pan a stage in a Jamaica now.
The flatness thing was farming roots.
In the
music. But I wanna say this though, and the thought just come to my mind. And I'm gonna group Sunsplash, Bob Marley and Usain Bolt together. Why am I doing that? Well, I just recently went and Usain Bolt did his last running, and I felt good to say, well, at least I can say I was part of the history there. Now, you have some people hear about Bob Marley and never get a chance to see Bob Marley, which is a big laugh. And then I'm saying this about Sunsplash. If you never get to experience Sunsplash, then you missed a big part of Jamaican culture.
All right, so all you that say, this evolution, some fest, they ever evolving to some fest, with the whole group, where you run it, say, one of the part there was really kind of the infusion of the hip hop culture for headline the some fest. As you know, the only other artists them where you sit there on Sunsplash was some African artists who play reggae. Yeah, you have a man of the bango who come to Jamaica, come make reggae. You have you, Matty Kayla, Lucky Dube.
I've never seen Angela, what's her name, Kojo.
Angelique Kijo, yes. Me did the panic stunt class when she did the panic.
Well, that's Saka Kova. I think you perform on that.
Yeah, man. I am then Burning Spear perform on that thing. And then now you have Stevie Wonder, who did write the song for Third World.
Yeah.
And then him come and do a tint with Third World on the stage, but it was really wow, you know.
Yeah, it was still fire, but him came on, and you know.
Yeah. So what may I say though, Ronnie Burke talked about the infusion of the hip-hop, and now we see not a new set of people. Joe come now, and him say, he's going to return it now to the purity where he talk about. It's just that now dance all its part, because at that time, you never have a genre where name dancehall. It's just reggae you didn't have. So now, what you think about that? What you think about the whole some fest vibes. That's
all. Well, when you look at it from the broader perspective, right? It seems to have, you know, like they say, what goes around comes around. It seems like the old revival, the other thing of revival, reggae, people want to go back to playing vinyl, reggae, and you have the whole dub revival coming in again, you know? And you find that the one drop is taking, is coming in again. You find artists using a strong one drop in the beat now. So the revival of reggae is resurfacing in a way that we thought change up and, you know, the new dancehall thing and all that. So I think everything is coming back into full circle where it started from. And where it started from is the one drop.
But you think the one drop will come back as the dancehall get more popular?
No, I would think one drop is coming back. Dancehall is going to be there, and if it gets popular, it's fine. It's not a matter. I don't see which one more popular. But what it is now that there's a need for message music. There's a need for music to inspire the people, because you see, when the economics get hard and tough, then we have to, the music is like a lifeline. The music is like a brain food. And so we're going to need the positive music, as you're saying, call upon the players and singers of instrument to deliver the message, call them going to the chambers and they come back out with the message like a poet. And so the people need that now to. So you find this is going to take its course. But another thing is too, is the radio has a lot to do with it, you know, in terms of feeding the people positive music. So the hip-hop is there, but I don't like what Joe's doing now is at the right time. It's the right time to make the transition, bring it back more to a root cause, sure.
No, I don't think it'll come back to the root culture. I think it'll come back to the popular Jamaican genre. If you look at, all right, you hear Ronnie Burton say the dancehall will always be the biggest night.
Exactly.
Yeah, so now, when you look at the lineup at some fest, it's mostly dancehall artists upon it.
Yeah.
Are there any of the what you call vintage artists them you will find upon it, in the rock to the era or the old roots dancehall artists.
Well,
so it's not like it'll come back to
the
reggae.
The evolution of it all is that the younger generation will dominate the fields of music more than
that. May I say, so when the argument about it coming back to the original way, I don't think it will come back to the original way.
It come back to the original way, but it will come, it will resurface where it have a dominancy in the whole scheme of things. But when you look at it, the younger generation will have more discretionary funds to support the music. And the older people now, they have less discretionary funds. Yeah. And at the same time, they may not be going out as much as the younger people who are ready to party and things like that. And there is going to come a time when they're not going to be going out that much, and another set of younger generation will take over the thing. So therefore, the music will always have its evolution and things in that way. But
I just refer to the argument of the one drop coming back.
Yeah, that
is really what I did refer to, that the one drop are coming back.
We would have to say then, to what degree is it coming back?
Yeah, well, it's a degree, but to say that it's going to come back, I am assuming that you say, when we look at the lineup now, eventually you're going to say.
I was actually saying in degree.
Okay.
A certain degree.
All right.
I am impressed to see all the things flowing at this time, because one time I did totally give up.
I am very impressed.
You what?
I say I am very impressed too. I am very impressed of what the Sumfest is offering now. You know, and I was impressed last year when him say him want to deal with reggae and dancer, opposed to the previous owners them who bring a foreign artist here, spend all sort of millions of US dollars upon them, and then them end up not being the major act on the show. I mean, when I say major act, they are they are said to be the major, the highlight of the show. But then you always have like a beanie man and a bounty killer will override them continuously. You know, so we don't know why we need something to build up the music. You know, like the music is already built. It just needs to know, expand it. You know?
I'm thinking that if you guys, they bring American crowd.
But it never happened. It never happened.
No, it never
because
happened.
Originally, it never reggae, you're Ronnie Burke talk about it. The reggae did a festival ever in a Jamaica. No other reggae festival bring tourists to like Reggae Sun
Splash. So we must let the people that know that Reggae Sun Splash
bring tourists to like Reggae Sun
Splash. So we must let the people that know that Reggae Sun Splash during its time all over the world.
All over.
Journalists, like all 160, 270 international journalists coming in to cover the festival, you know.
Yeah, I'd like to see if Joe, well, 1 year gone, this is his second year, him say it's gonna be bigger. Last year was big. Last year, I think, was one of the biggest some fests. Him say it's gonna be bigger this year. I'd like to see, in the beginning of it, how much foreigner it can draw to Jamaica. Because I think that is what is missing out of the reggae in the festival them in Jamaica, because it draw what the foreign show them draw reggae artists to them, but we don't see the foreigners them who is the audience being drawn to Jamaica like all the foreign artists is drawn to the festival them in Europe and America. I think right. That is what is missing in the equation. The equation is that these festivals like Joe Now and Tony Rebel, make us see if these festivals can draw 100 ad, 200 ad journalists from all over the world.
Yeah. And you know, that time too, the caliber of artists that were around then had a lot to do with it too.
With the draw, with the pull of the foreigners.
Yeah, the caliber of artists that were around. And another thing was good with Sun Splash too. They used to do the tour before Reggae Sun Splash. They used to go on the road with the festival.
Yes, yeah, and then all come to Jamaica with it.
Yeah, and so people were motivated and got aware of what was happening and things like that.
Yeah,
so we have to look at the foreign market because we need a foreign currency. And, you know, the Jamaican dollars, you point out what we were paying for them to go
to $5.
And it still don't add up to what we were paying then, you know. Or current,
in 1986, you have in the book here, in 1986, it went to $40. So from $5 at the first stage, which is 7 years after, 8 years after, it went to $40 from $5. 7 years after, really, it's amazing.
You know, we all need to think foreign currency, you know, producing, you know, foreign currency into the country, whether that's producing through the music, arts and crafts, all these things, because of the weakness of our currency, we have to pull the foreign currency in. So that means we have to look at the market and pull the currency in. So that means we have to look at the market out there and see how we can attract them to Jamaica.
Yeah, but we attract what are we attracting to Jamaica, you know? It's just that the harnessing of it is what, this is where the so-called government, them politicians, them lack. Because we pull it because we go there and get it and bring it come here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, see, what we want now is for some man bring it come here, but you see, them concentrate on tourism. And them said tourism is the biggest draw for foreign currency, you know, and what them call the Western Union money, the remittance them. You have a music right now where if you play the card right, and if Joe and Tony Rebel, because we have to talk about Joe now and Tony Rebel, because the two biggest one them there so now, we left. If Joe and Tony Rebel play them card right, I mean, really and truly, the artists them, see at all. Because if them stay here, the people them is forced to come here. If them want to them great artists, them have to come here at all.
Well, again, you know, we have to look at the situation of sponsorship and where does that, what role does that play? And yes, and historically speaking, at one time, reggae was not allowed to play on the radio.
Yeah, but it's a play enough, I know.
Even when it got to play on radio, it was not permitted to play on Sunday.
Yes. And so, now we have a regular radio station. Now we have 20 at radio station, really.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can look on something else. So we also not deal with the entrance fee. After we reach from 1986 to $40, in 1992, it got to $150. So it'll take a little while for really jump to
that level. Yeah, 92 was really still, and it wasn't too bad.
No, because it was in the Bob Marley Entertainment Center, where them call Bob Marley Entertainment Center. After that, them lick it down. It's a terrible thing in a Montego Bay. That was really something else, really tear down that place. Because I thought it was going to be developed in actually a serious music center.
Yeah.
When I hear to the man, them I lick it down for put house some parties, I say, what? Once again, the people, them not interested in a reggae music. You know?
Well, with Synergy was having financial problems.
Yeah, they mentioned
that. Right through, and they were just in the love for the music for the most part. But it would have been great in that period if we had get, I think, 20 acres of land somewhere, somehow, to make a land along the tourist side, such that.
And I would have land the place to do it too.
Like entertainment complex, you know, because the instability of Sunsplash have to move all around the place, you know.
That cause a breakdown. And you know the weirdest thing about it, where I find, all right, them when the cricket thing did that happen, them find a place in a Trelawney to build a sports stadium.
It's mostly
music playing there.
Well, they don't use it for cricket no more.
No, it's mostly music. It's a music when reggae, Jamaica Jazz Festival. No, most of the music they're playing there.
Alright, so you see, come right back to the music again.
I tell you, terrible.
But, hey, I don't, I hear the comments made earlier that the politician doesn't really see the significance of reggae. I think that they really see it, but that is not what they want to market at, because you have done, you know, the whole thing of singing liberation songs and all
them
things there.
Yeah, but brethren, that hardly I make no, you know. Liberation song hardly I make no, you know.
That is true.
Every song, most of the song, wind up and come down, it's like, man, I want to vomit now, man. I look at my TV and music, I see the mount of bottom where I see my face, I know I don't even have to look at my wife phone at all.
And Becky Dempsey taking over.
Yeah, so, you know, it's like, them have a reason for promote it now. Because when them really are dealing with this, where really they know. That's why you see all of the company, them know a jump on the bandwagon now, you know, because it is no more radically, you know, a Mutabaruka or a Burning Spear or a Peter Tosh, you know. It is now decadent to the levels now where them can jump in there with them liquor and alcohol and drunk after the youth them and get them and talk about.
Yeah,
responsibly.
When we grew up, you know, alcohol.
No. I remember. I want to tell you guys something, you know. I forgot to mention it to Ronnie Burke, you know. There was a drug-free thing happening in arena, you know, and then put me upon it. And when me there behind the stage, me see Jerry and him nephew backing running like worries. So I go up on the stage and I say, me not understand how this is a concert we are look out against drugs. And Jerry and him never the backstage. Ratted. For years, including Sunsplash, them say if Mutabaruka dey on the show, them not sponsored. And Ronnie Burke say, hey, watch your man. Mutabaruka dey on the show. And Ronnie Burke stand up to them and put me on the show all through the years, and them never sponsor it again. And right now, we don't see them as sponsor. And it be like a naughty to that them out now. I say, Jerry and them nephew, It's a terrible thing. So right now it's rum place. Alcohol is one of the biggest promoters now of dancehall music.
That is promoting to the young people now.
Young people, yes, it drive them now. It's not like we our days now when we did young and we are dealing with ital liberty and, you know, ital food and conscious lyrics and all them something. It's a total different thing, you know. So me don't know, me don't know. I mean, but me still want the festival them.
Yes,
in a Jamaica. In a Jamaica, me talk about.
Yes,
in a Jamaica. Because
when you check it, you come festival and go on abroad now. It's like them want make Jamaica like Jamaica now really depend the level like them depend. And
yeah,
we did it before, cause we set it and them come and pattern it. So
yes.
We have to make it. So,
definitely. And we are say festival is live and well in a Jamaica. Some fest live and well. Tony Rebel Salute, live and well.
And don't forget to Rebel has his share of struggle as well.
Of course. All of them have struggle. You know, Rebel never start out like, you know, how some fest start out, really.
Times,
yes, just like when you youth them. Just like when Johnny Burke them was youth and them start out, I see me a Rebel start out. You know, I was not the first Rebel Salute. And still there with him 20 odd years after, you know, them were there. So we wish them success. Anyway, Bridging, which part of them can get your book? Which part of them can get?
Right now, boy, it's a shame I get so burned out after doing the book. It don't get for a while, but Bridging, I can't keep the marketing going. My biggest site is disappointed. Publishing.
Well, I don't know what's going to happen now, you know, because people are going to ask for the book. I don't know where I would do, you know, they're going to ask for it.
Yeah, well, them can, I don't know, their number, they want call, they can call.
Then tell them the number, man, tell them the number.
850-2257,
850-2257. All right, 850-2257, if you want a copy of this book, yeah. Reggae Sunsplash 1978 to 1998 by Java Emmanuel I.
And let me say this, you know, this book is an historical book.
Mm.
And as the years go on, the book is more valuable.
Definitely. You know? And I know several people in Europe now listen to this program, yeah, and they want to order all 500 for putting at them festival. You think I drew up me, I make Java, yeah. I put in a jet pan, you know.
And look,
as
me know, say the crowd out,
man,
and them listen.
Yeah. I cut in the depan, you know. Me why you make some money off of your book after 9 years, you know, Rasta. And me say, people out there listening.
I don't really want to recover cars, but I give thanks I was able to put something out there. And when I see all a girl come from Spain and see my book on display at an event, and she gonna say to me, she said, you have the record Sunsplash here? I said, of course, because they had the Sunsplash over there going for quite a while, for years. And a new generation come and talk, they created Sunsplash.
Mm.
So it's all about protecting our culture, protecting our music. So another one from another country can come through and say, and then they start this, and then they do that.
The note here, the blueprint here, Reggae Sunsplash. But I want to tell you, now, if you carry this book here, if you carry 300-400 of this book, Rio River, or Sierra Nevada, or Rotterdam, or any one of the festivals, you know, trust me, you make back the money where you say never make the 9 years, and right now you need to do it now because you depend on the radio, yeah.
Vintage, because a man looking there and see Reggae like that. I said, you never know Reggae did laugh.
Yeah, and see me all in a chain here tonight.
Mutabaruka.
I want a picture here, you know. I want a picture here. Trust me. You have a picture here still?
Eh?
You have a picture here still with me in the chains?
Yeah, I suppose, yeah, man. And I want to tell you another short piece in my mind. So, is the one at Chakakova when did he come out with them magnificent.
With the dance of them. Yeah, I see you now. Lantonette Steins and I answer them, yes.
Yeah.
You have all them picture there.
Presentation, man, because I always reinventing. Yeah, you know, that's a beautiful thing.
Give thanks, Bridget. Give thanks. You know, give thanks.
Thanks. Bless up.
All right. Yes, that was Java Emmanuel. I bet you don't know for years. You matter what him do. I interviewed me before or third front in about 30 odd years ago. Reggae Sun Splash 1978, 1998 by Java Emmanuel. And we are telling about maybe somebody going to take up the idea now for Chronicle. Some face, because that need for Chronicle too. That need for Chronicle too. From the time when it start, I think in 1993 it start. And so, 1993 it start, and no one, I mean it's at 25 years. 25 years of some face. And we see it go through management change. Now we see a man come now and say, look you know, we are going right through reggae and dancehall. I'm involved in the hip-hop business. We're going to see how long him can hold on for that. Joe, anyway there. Anyway, anybody will know. Joe, tell us a Muta say. We're going to see how long him can hold on for the hardcore reggae and dancehall as part of him newly found toy. Reggae Sumfest. By the way, Reggae Sumfest are next month, right? And the next month, July. Me de panit, you know, a MC, me and Elise Kelly. Wow. Yes, and Ran Mouchette. Wow. We are MC one night. So, more the people them know say, yeah, man. See, it's sweet. Jamaica for preserve, we for preserve the things. We for preserve things. We can't complain, so all the way, you understand? And if we now use our radio, if we promote with things, I'm not talking about buying advertisement and all them things there, but real and true, there are certain things where in order to make it go out there that you can make money, you have to give it a push. Because the more we push it, is the more the radio station will also make money and fight too. You understand? And we are saying, okay, I make money after some Sunsplash again. Because the man them retire now, two man out of four man left out of the whole scheme of the thing, and two man left out of it. This book here is very important to me personally, because I feel say at time black people write their own history, and this is one of the black history where black people write. And now some face come now, Jamaican vibes, Jamaican music, we need to chronicle it too. I just saw it go.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
how
are you? All right, sir.
Man, before we're going any further, I have to thank you. Because you are into the history from way back when, but and you come right up to present day.
Yes.
I appreciate that.
All right, sir. Give thanks.
All right. You mentioned some names tonight that I've never heard for a long time. You mentioned the Blues Busters.
Yes.
Barry and the Celestials.
Yeah, the Blues Busters come from Mobile, you know.
Yes, Santa, I've come from Mobile too, and the Celestials come from Mobile
too, yes.
Yeah, I remember the days when the Celestials and the Blues Busters used to come up to, with a club name, the Sombrero Club.
Yeah, me remember my man on Mullines Road.
Yes,
yeah.
And there was a man there called Alvaro Castro.
Yeah.
And Mr. Castro, in other words, every year, there was a and we win most of the time, but I realized that them days you were around.
Yeah, me a little bit of them days, you know, but me did bad.
Young people, hey, I was a young boy, I said that them days.
No, man, me tell something that me used to do, man. Me used to have my khaki clothes in my bag. I when Mary Tone done. No,
don't let out yourself too much.
No, but nobody can beat me. My mother could have beat me. Nobody can beat me.
But I tell you something. You mentioned about when things happened in Montego Bay, you know why it took off so well? There were two guys down there, one named Lance Selwell and the Celestials.
Yeah.
And there was another one called Dennis Robinson. Those two guys, them used to work with the airlines, and they were the ones who push it out and make a lot of announcement all over the place.
Yeah.
Every person who come through the airport, them give them a little card and say, well, come back, make sure you come back by such and such a date, because that is when we're going to be having
Sunsplash.
Huh?
But that's when you're going to have sun splash.
Yes.
Guys,
they're not getting little tongues, they're not getting little on, but me know they did that.
Of course.
Because I was living in California at the time, and I'm saying to me, I'd say, well, all right, next, if this thing goes through, we're going to do another thing the next year, and I'm doing it. And I was over in California, and I get to push things.
Yeah.
And after it was over in Los Angeles, I remember asking the young people at the high school, I said, who the favorite artist? They say, we never see him. But the favorite artist was Yellowman.
Yeah.
He wasn't there. I don't remember if he was there, but they say Yellowman is our favorite artist because he sings God's gift to women, and so do we. I said, the boy,
all of the DJ them think that. Tell them it's God's gift to women.
We have been through a lot after all these years,
yes,
but keep it up because
there.
It's people like you who keep things going.
I know, so I'm going to play a tune for you.
Eh?
I'm going to play a tune for you.
No, the last time I asked you for a tune, you never get to me, though.
No, but I'm going to give you that one, because I ask you for it. No, I'm going to tell you about it now. A blues bust, I'm going to play for you.
All right, but I tell you what, you will look for me now. When you Masekela came here in the world of days.
You mentioned that already now.
Yes, I never find it.
But me not find it.
But you know what it was? I remember the tune, Terranova. You say that the Terranova hotel.
Oh, you say you remember the tune that you thought of MC.
It just got me. No.
The last time you called a couple months ago, you told me you want to hear a you Masekela tune.
Yes.
I can't remember the name. No, a while ago you say you remember the name. Him still at Terranova. Is that the tune name?
That is one of them. I don't know if you... Yeah, I think that's one.
The tune name, him still at Terranova?
Yes, man.
Hold on. I could get something clear. The music where you want to hear name, it's him still at Terranova.
No, it's called Terranova after the hotel where you stay when them come to Jamaica.
Oh, all right.
I understand what I said.
All right, so let me play this and look.
A long time, watching me.
All right, let me play that tune. I go look for it. All right.
All right.
Yeah. May I tell you, anytime I listen to them, remember James and Bobby Purified. For those of you who know the music from them time, there is a duo. Well, James and Bobby Purify are two men and sing Cedric. And them sound like them. Believe you me. This is the cutting edge. Yes, EL.
Blessed love, MUTABARUKA.
Blessed man.
Love the vibe, sir.
Yeah, man. Don't change it. Don't change the vibe. Don't change the vibe.
No, I will change it
still. Yeah.
Don't watch it towards the music thing. I say, them time there. To this time, if the youth and all we have to do the music thing and all we have to really realize and listen to them music there. The money, I really like the music so derogative now, you know. That is something when them have the radar, on the radar and dance hall and them something there. I'm sure the mother come out of the studio, you know. Power. You take a check. So the studio, man, the owner for the studio is supposed to get them kind of thing that come through the system, you know. So they use them out there and they use them to spread out the thing.
Yeah, but I use them and make the tune them. I mean, you know. You mean, say them should
not
allow.
Yeah, but what I say, them should not allow that.
Who should not allow it?
The musician, a
computer, the man them I use. Most of the time them a computer, you know, so I know like, musician should not love it. Musician want eat food too, so them make the tune where, sometimes you don't know who go up on the rhythm. You know, you say all 10, 20 hours, they on one rhythm.
We don't eat food, but any kind of
No, but listen to me, hold on there. Wait, hold on there, brethren, hold on there. A man have some money, a producer, and him call five musicians to make a rhythm. And the musician, they make the rhythm, they don't know who walk up on the rhythm. They make the rhythm, yes. And then the producer go now and call some artists and put on the rhythm.
So yeah, so the producer him come like a reducer now, you know, because I'm a reducer, the total inspiration and thing, you know, bring it in some reactive way.
Yeah.
And I call some old people that are chaos, cuss, and man, I take all them private bedroom thing, you know, and I tell them, I'm
using that. Stage, I put on stage.
Yeah. So I say, when I go up on all the stage, you know, and all the musicians, them, I play all them things, them for them, but I play them, them kind of thing for them people.
You mean on the stage? You know, them shouldn't play it on the stage?
No, they don't play that. Them for them people go one side, they clean up them up, man.
You have a bridging name, Warrell King. You have a bridging name, Warrell King, where in the start a band and him say, no artists will use certain things and certain things. And him did really hold on to that too. It make him bad.
Yeah.
Him now back up, no ladies, sir, and no this and that. With the companies.
No, what if you see them thing, I know the music are forward, some, you know, I don't know the derogative thing, you know.
Yeah.
And music's supposed to bring, clean sensation to each and every one, you know.
Yeah.
So right now, the one I'm turning to the war, I'm turning to the all kind of look of filthiness.
Mm.
We need to realize, man, because if you have a continuity, we have a lose out everything, you know.
Yes. Yeah, we understand, Reggie.
I'm telling you, watch over thing I go on, man. Some of the money, man, ask you, you know what I'm saying, you can hear them, with them gone, far away, leave them.
Mm. All right, we have to move, though, Reggie, we have to move. That word is
better. I want to go man, there's something where serious, man. I don't know, look a joke thing with the pan.
All right,
so. The music thing, man.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the cutting edge. And I refer him there with you, yes. EL.
EL Muta.
Ah, bless him, man. Dingo, you know, man.
Yeah, man. You know, you know, first thing I want to say, you know, is condolences to the, you know, and friends of at least the 12 people so far who have died as a result of that horrific fire in the Ladbroke Grove area of West London, you know, yesterday morning by Grenfell Tower. Because some of who died are some of our African people, you know, from various places, Africa, here, elsewhere, you know. And the council is fully responsible because it was something that the residents complained about in terms of safety and so. Even last year they said that it seems like a catastrophe is going to happen for things really sad, you know.
All right, you so know, let me ask that question now. How much, you know, them have an idea how much people living at a skyscraper building there? How much people living there?
Yes, it's 124 floors. So about a thousand.
Yeah, families with look a picnic and all them here there.
Yes. Yeah, people show their babies through, you know, from the 9th floor.
Then we don't see a man that jump, I don't know if it's a man, but we see somebody that jump off with fire upon them back.
Yes, people jump out, yes, a kind of reminder of Twin Towers in New York City where people jump, you know, desperation rather than to be burnt alive, you know.
Yeah.
You know, real sad. I mean, it's an area that I know very, very well, you know, that Ladbroke Grove, Latimer Road is here in West London. That's the area to where we have Notting Hill Gate Carnival, you know.
Yeah.
You know.
Let me ask you something, you know. Them find out what caused the fire yet?
Officially not yet, but what I can tell you is that a brother who was interviewed, who lived on the 4th floor, said that his neighbor told him that his fridge exploded.
You see, Ross?
And then from his fridge exploded to fire. But what caused the spread of the fire, you know, is that the council made some builders have put on the outside of the Grenfell Tower some cladding to make the place look so-called pretty. But the cladding is made up of very inflammable
like plastic,
material.
Like plastic.
And this is why fire spreads so much.
It's because like
it's coated with, you know, this cladding is made up of material which is very plastic, inflammable. So this is why within 30 minutes the whole place was engulfed in flames.
Them say the fire brigade say come along there, 200.
Yeah, the, over 200, a little, about 200 fire brigade personnel that were working, you know, and thing. And what it goes to show, you know, is that really and truly, every home should have fire extinguishers, both for water and for electrical.
And fire escape.
Yes, and also fire extinguishers.
Yeah.
Because, you know, fire can take place at any time. I remember growing up, my parents always had a fire extinguisher. No fires took place at the home, but we had a fire extinguisher, you know. Car prevent is always better than cure, and condolences where that is concerned. And also, I'm glad to know that Arthur Robinson Bonney, that is service at the Seventh Day Adventist Church by North, you know, and he was buried at Meadow Rest.
Hold on, I could have left England yet, man.
Last week,
talk about the election, we want to talk about, you know. The election part, no, because it's from like your personal.
Well, where the election is concerned, is that what Jeremy Corbyn has done with his manifesto and his very commendable campaign is that he has prevented the Tories led by Theresa May of increasing
the majority to
come to full power. So this is why they have had to add an alliance, because the meeting's still going on with the DUP from Northern Ireland, who are a Protestant political party.
But
all we're seeing it is that this thing is not going to work for too long. We're looking out for another election soon, and the hope is by me and others, Corbyn leading Labour will win.
But I see them
because this is how the signs are going.
I see them try each and the bricks thing by the table again.
Yes. What happened is that how it is looking right now, if an election was called right now as we speak, it would be Jeremy Corbyn winning, you know? And we don't see this Theresa May alliance of marriage of convenience in the DUP lasting for too long. Because one of the things that a lot of the Tories don't like with the DUP is that they are totally opposed to same-sex so-called marriage. And they are totally opposed to abortion. As one of them said in Northern Ireland, Peter shall not marry Paul.
Well,
as George has run the chance, says she's a dead woman walking, because what happened is that her authority has been severely undermined, because her colleagues are seeking to get rid of her because they are blaming her for calling an election that she thought they would win. And she has turned off a lot of the Tory people by her, what you call, hearty and attitude.
Who is the Prime Minister of England after the election?
The Prime Minister is Theresa May.
All right. So is Theresa May the Prime Minister? Concede that she will, you know, like, you know, I concede that. I
mean, she has not won. It's not like that. Okay. I am, let me explain again.
Okay.
Because she did not win an overall majority as Tory to form the government. Yeah. She has been forced to do a deal
alliance.
With the DUP was then, yeah. Without the DUP. So because of that, they are asking for things that she cannot refuse,
yes.
If she wants to be the prime minister. Yeah. So her power has been diminished.
Yeah, we know that.
And also some of her rivals for the leadership in the Tory party, like Boris Johnson and others, and so.
Yeah.
That she was seeking that if she had won by an increased majority, she would be able to get rid of her. Run things totally. That has been defeated because of her loss to what she had before.
Me hear what you say.
Yes, I'm, yes. So that is a political reality. You see, she's in a very vulnerable
position
politically.
Okay. All right.
You see,
yeah.
And thing, you know, and. Just want to say also that, you know, I'm really glad to hear that Custer Avenue in Montego Bay is going to be renamed Jimmy Cliff Boulevard, you know, and I have Jimmy Cliff, you know.
Yeah.
I'm a man who was an international reggae superstar from in the late 1960s, you know, all over, you know, West Africa and other places.
You didn't hear the sun splash
reasoning? Sorry? Yes, I am also. I do know that book written about Reggae Sunsplash from 1978 to 1998.
Yeah.
So that's 20 years. When it started, $5 entrance fee.
I tell you.
You know what I mean? $5 entrance fee, you know.
Ronnie Burke, who is the founder of this thing, laugh when he hear me say $5. I can't remember. He might remember to really $5 for two.
Yes, for real, you know, and Ronnie really has done, you know, some great work in those times where Reggae Sunsplash is concerned, you know, and it was really something else and for the promotion of reggae music,
because
we need to have our own reggae to bring people
to
from outside of Jamaica to come to reggae.
Instead of all of the artists them are left, go over Europe. Make some of the people them who are promoting the thing them come over Jamaica.
Because they will be forced to come to Jamaica if they want to hear the artists.
Yes.
And of course the reason why a lot of the artists go outside of Jamaica. I mean, and of course, they must tour outside of Jamaica.
Yeah.
But the reason why so many of them go is because of a lack of the amount of reggae festivals in Jamaica.
Yeah.
And this is why things like Rebel Salute and so on, you know, which came on after Reggae Sunsplash and things like that, you know, we need to increase and have more of that because this is something which is absolutely necessary. Because it's only we can promote our own thing to safeguard our culture, my financial benefits from our culture.
Yeah.
You know, we definitely have to. You know, as Marcus Garvey says about self-reliance, we're talking and complaining is not gonna work.
No.
We have to put in place the things, you know. And we have a situation in Jamaica still with the 2 o'clock, with the sound system thing, that sound systems must be turned off, whereas in countries abroad, reggae music and other forms of music are not under any 2 o'clock curfew ban.
No, hold on. You didn't hear the first part of the program?
The very first part.
All right, we're looking for. They have curfew in other countries. As a matter of fact, the festival that I attended this weekend is 8 o'clock, is the cut-off time for that festival. In the day.
Where was this now? Where was this?
Right in Queens, New York. Rye Simmons. Simmons' name? Everybody. Anyway, I have been on tours already where them have curfew. Curfew meaning say you have to cut off at a certain time. Them do allow you to go past a certain time.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? And it's not like Jamaica where them tell you say 12 and the thing go to 1. For them say 12, police come there lock it off, or the man them lock off the light for you. So it's not
really. Yeah, Muta, what I'm saying is this.
Yeah.
Is that while you have cut off times everywhere in the world, what I'm saying is that there's more leverage in terms of times with reggae concerts and that type of thing abroad generally. There's more time allocated in terms of the time, and the 2 o'clock curfew in Jamaica with sound system that promote the music, you know, is that turn down the sound at 2 o'clock, but don't turn it off.
Yeah, but
turn down the sound system.
Them all right, turn down the sound system, and when the police move, them turn it up back. And that's not that.
Well, what must happen is that the penalty for turning it up back after then the full weight of the law must
them,
be brought down here.
But they have a penalty fee, you know. But hear what me say now. Me understand this thing about lock off and thing, but you know, brethren, you have some people I keep dancing, Rasta, and them not have no intention to consider other people in areas where it's also built up here where people want to sleep, people come home late at night, people want to sleep, old people there, they were sick, picnic there, they want to do them homework and things. And the man, them turn up, they said, that is not music they are playing now. Something to my cause bad when I make all that.
Yes. And I agree with you that things like that, cussing bad word over the mic and that type of thing, that they should be prosecuted. Where that is concerned, and also what should happen to is that there should be efforts to have certain areas,
you know, like
whereby the general public are not inconvenienced by that.
That's why I know say the politician them a joke. Because you know, long from the other government and the other government and the other party I talk about designated areas up to this day.
Designated area, exactly.
Up to this day we can't hear us in no designated area. You know, just like how we are waiting for the place to keep the music where it's comfortable and progressive. Up to now we can't hear nothing more than that. So we don't know. We don't know.
It shows the hypocrisy that they talk about designated areas, but they only talk about it and not doing anything to implement, you know, the making of these designated areas, you know. And I must say that some of the younger set of artists are really continuing with the positive lyrics for reggae music. I mean, for example, on Thursday the 22nd of June in London, Kabaka Pyramid will be performing.
Yeah.
Protege was here recently, Chronics was here recently.
Yeah.
Bigotan, the artist from Manchester, Jamaica, who has toured China and other places, he was here recently. So it's good to know that we have a younger generation of artists who have positive lyrics where reggae music is concerned, and as in every generation, you have the artists with the positive lyrics. That's a reality, because remember in the 60s we had music like Big Five,
Rika Poom and all them thing there.
Remember, you know, with sexual overtones, you know, and that type of thing. So it's not anything new, you know.
It wasn't the main course. It wasn't the main course, bro. Those music wasn't the main course.
No, it wasn't the main course. It was part of the course, but it wasn't the main course.
No, it is the main course.
But in recent times, the negative lyrics of weed overtake the garden. You know what I mean?
Yeah, man. It's not only the main course, you know, but it's all dessert you're getting for too.
Yes, it's true. But what we have to do, what we have to do. This situation, you know what I'm saying, you know, and I wanna let us again, I already mentioned it, but I am mentioning it again, remembering Leonard Percival, all from Clarendon, yes. Jamaica, yeah. Original Gavia Itu's, yes. 119th anniversary,
yes.
Will be this coming Friday the 16th, you know, yes. Born 1898, and left us on the 25th of February 1981.
Yeah.
And I want to yell up his daughter who is in Florida in the States, Kathy Howell, you know.
Yes, yes, yes.
And also my sister who I went to school with at Friendship Government School, St. John's Road, where my parents taught, Louise Watson, known as Joyce, who grew up as a little girl living in front of Pinnacle, still lives there. You know, she was able to tell me a lot about
what's going on up there?
Leonard Percival Owell and his wife and thing. Yeah, because she lived literally. Leonard, I mean, Louise Watson, we call her Joyce. And anybody who listening, they will know that in that area, to big up, tell Louise Watson, Joyce, that Mandingo,
yeah.
Our schoolmate at Friendship Government School Center, so for bigger up. Yes. So keep up the good work.
Yeah, man,
and stay strong.
Yeah, man.
Blessed love.
Hello. Yes, EL. EL?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Blessed man. Cutting edge.
Blessed. Did you come and see your son there, no?
Better hear you.
No, because I came and saw your son there.
Rye Wilkins Park. Oh, you did it Sunday, you say? Oh, okay. Yeah, man, Rye.
Yeah, man. Yeah, there's many people there, man. What do you do? That makes you so much.
But you're broke up, though, you know. Come through. Oh, you're supposed to come through, you know. You know what I mean?
Yeah, hear me now?
Yeah, me, I hear you now, yes.
No, me, I say, yeah, there's many people there, man. They're not bad, me, you're so much.
Me, what you say? Me, I hear you. Me, I do what?
I say
you have to go call again, you know. Trust me. You have to go call again. Believe you me, you have to call again. And get a different phone or come from under your bed or something. Yes. Okay. Make we play this tune, yeah. Since you that talk to Mandingo, yeah. Yel.
Yel, Mota.
Blessed man.
Mota.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man, pick up yourself. I said, I wait to see you 8 hours Sunday and I have left.
You wait 8 hours to see me that Sunday?
Yeah, and I don't see at all. I don't know what time you come on. I'm left at 7:10.
Oh, wait, I said, man, be yourself, man.
You have to come back.
Hold on. The show. And you left at 7:10. And you never see me on the stage, no time at all?
No time at all. I'm less. Wait, 10 minutes past 7 or something.
You did it when Sister Carol come on the stage?
Yeah, man.
You did it when Sister Carol come on the stage?
Yeah.
No, remember good. You did it when Sister Carol come on the stage. Remember good, you know. You don't know who named Sister Carol?
Problem.
Really, you don't know who named Sister Carol?
The young girl,
what do you say, brother? Man, may I ask you a question? You did dead when Sister Carol come on the stage?
No,
you did when Glenn Washington come on the stage? Wait, no, you did dead when Glenn Washington come on the stage? I don't know who named Glenn Washington.
No, I never see
it. You never see it on the show then? You don't see the show?
Even
something like that. When Chilla you, or yeah, something like that. You, right, come you don't know Chilla you don't know Glenn Washington, you don't know Sister Carol. I mean, make you come there.
Yeah, man, are you?
But you were me at now. But you were me at now. Me did there. Me don't know where you say. Me the dead. Me not understand why you left 7 o'clock. Me the dead.
Yeah, me never see you still. Me tell you, but at the same time, it's a good thing to come still. I met some good connection with some people, you know?
Good, beautiful.
You know, and me see a lady where some brother me and I just click, and she said, me go introduce the motor when motor come, and tell, she has to like, say, grant it to them God parents or something like that, you know? make some good connection. Good. Yeah, you know what I mean?
So you did it from when? How much o'clock you go there? 10 o'clock?
I go there about 10 o'clock.
In the morning?
But through me that for combat, down here.
Are you still till 7 o'clock? Are you still till 7 o'clock in the evening?
Yeah.
Are you not see me?
We did it. I like the vibes, you know?
Yeah, I come after 6. But after 6, I come but I did run at the backstage there.
Yeah, you know, but...
That's how it go.
Yeah, next time. Me have a good vibe. You know, me love
that. I'm glad to hear that. So, you know, you come back long here now.
I'm Massachusetts.
You drive from and come down there?
Yeah, man. When they tell the people, yo,
You didn't hear the first part of the program. You didn't hear the first part of this program when me that talk?
No.
The last artist
for Kwan.
I want to tell you.
Yeah.
The last artist for Kwan Panisage was Ky-Mani. The show was supposed to be done 8 o'clock, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Ky-Mani Marley the Panisage 11 minutes past 8. And the police them come backstage. Two white policemen come and say, cut, stop. So everybody get frantic now and I go on the stage. Forgot tell Ky-Mani, say, must stop it. The police them say, must stop. You see, meanwhile, when they on the stage, I try to tell Ky-Mani, must stop it. One of the white policemen, they run, go on the stage. And hold up a man and say, one more. Me say, the place is the tear duct rotted.
The place is the tear duct.
Can you imagine? A policeman come on the stage in a New York. I used when Ky-Mani hug him up, so him hug up and Ky-Mani and have up him hand in the ear. I say one more, me I tell it.
You see the vibe like me, I say, what happened there, son, or no? It's like, all of we that be yourself, you know. Yeah. Everybody there shall be themselves.
Yeah, man. No, us,
I don't see one negative, nothing, I go on nowhere there, you know.
A true man.
You know what I mean? I tell you, say, me never go among people because I just approach one. You see, I'll people over you and I here, table.
Oh gosh,
and this
man!
This from me, this from me there.
Yeah,
right,
from the
get team, and this from me there.
Them a come long here, August. I go and bring them part of this program because them start something where them have a warehouse, no food, where them a try bring.
Yeah, man, them tell me about that, man. Them tell me about Arab, you know. Leave me through that.
Yeah, man.
You know.
Anyway, we have to move, Rachel.
Yeah, man, the big fireball and the whole East Kingston and big up my and this lender car. She understand what I'm going, you know, little by little.
You know Queen's good?
No, you know,
Arrange to rent the car. Father's Day, you know, you hear little things there and hear little things there, but you know, hear little things everywhere. It's a weird little thing. Fathers, but you must look upon what that mean. Believe you me. Yes, Ill.
Well, Mota.
Blessed man.
Yeah, man. I'm kind of coming from the program late. I look a part of the
Sun's Flash
1928 to 98, I think.
Okay, so, yeah.
You know, but me think me a man thing, so I think like, but the Irish, them both, the Peter can something like that. The middle of our friends, the Peter from my father, or whatever. But I wonder if you know, hear the news, but somebody another, some big politician up there, a leader, you know, one of them happy fellows where come from India, the Indian there, and he's very happy. So I don't know why I know Peter will start my father up there.
No, but the Irish Prime Minister is a outside, is a gay person.
Yeah.
Man, the Prime Minister is a professed gear. Him no in another closet.
The Johnny Masaya, who I'm a type.
Yeah.
And I no more fussing and fighting.
Yeah.
I'm doing anything like it. You ever hear about Johnny Masaya here in that sense, and I'm here to Rastaman. I never Babka getting that. They were here to Rastaman, I argue.
Yeah.
That sense, you know, to Rastaman, who?
No.
Bob Marley, Leonard Owens. Yeah, the problem I have, you right, you know? I said that inspired to sing the song. No more forcing on or fighting.
They
hold me tight. Hey. Are you
supposed
to hear that still? Well, you know, I don't know what them like, you like when you tell them Bob Clark and OB and all them people
that you do. It's so like where you are here.
Huh?
When you listen to the words of the tune, it sound like where you hear.
Oh, well, you know, that's no more fussing and fighting. Wrong to me, I mean, the part like it's a woman in my past, and I said, you know, the part like it's a domestic dispute.
Yeah.
You know. So, but it's like, in terms of the inspiration, I'm getting, you know, I mean, to ask that, it will be coming like a family.
Alright, make we listen to the tune. No, because I want to hear if it can fit. If it can fit, what you say? Who you say it's a two rocker man in a fight when him write it?
No, I'm a fight, you know. It's in that tombstone and in here, I'm going to argue, you know.
Okay.
Then I don't want to something, man, Bob Marley.
Yeah, I understand.
You know, yeah, just a little, you know.
Alright, make we go listen to the tune, yeah? Alright.
I don't want to hear it, no more fussing and a fight, baby. Hold me tight. Let's let bygones be bygones. Let's think about tomorrow, girl. Our future's bright. I know I was wrong, but I was just a fool, too blind to see. You are the only girl for me.
Yo. No. That's not going to work, you know. That interpretation is not going to
work.
It's not like you want to believe it, you know. Like Jamaica, you know the truth about Jamaica, yeah. I am Benny King.
Yeah.
Benny King said true about Jamaica, you know, it sound like a girl in my talk about. So what you say now, this sound like a girl, but it's really two rasta man.
And so the end of I say, when did time did complain?
Yeah.
I spent stone in there, and he
Two rats attack. Him just turn, him just put a twist to it.
Yeah,
it will twist, bro.
I turn that big hit.
It will twist. It will make it.
I'm still hearing the music. It will make with the reggae, with all kind of genre of music.
Mm.
With the kind of familiar and mixed birds in the with the radio station. Like, they have something at home over there where, like, some people come there and deal with some old people are getting to go take music lessons and that kind of thing. And them say, like, the man did that with a research and thing, and he trying to, like, the first, what a Jamaica, is a Jamaican, the only oratorio in a big side of the world. You know, when I come out of Europe and everything, the whole of the Americas, South America, Central America, America, Caribbean, everywhere, a Jamaica. It's a Jamaican, the first one. You know, oratorio, like a religious music, or whatever, like something like opera almost. I mean, it's a Jamaican in them kind of music, but it's back in the 1800s.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, for good things, we have heard about the music. But yeah. This is music, man, because, you know, when you people are talking about the world, it's a slap, and them things, you know. Me, no say, one of the things you say wrong about it is when I up on the road, I play all about it, every couple of things, everybody. Yeah, back in the business, it's a place for a long time, but
it's when they're in the
damn hall where people may go.
Yeah. Please don't touch me tomato and all them something like
that. Alright, you know, it's in a code. It's in a code, yeah. You know?
Except for Prince Buster. Rekka Pum Pum, all them children Prince Buster make.
Well, it's part of one, you know. But even when I started having all them
when the young girl was.
You know? Mm. But that they meant to them, it was a long time.
Oh gosh, man. And they meant to them wicked, man.
Night food.
You know the name Night Food?
Yeah, oh, dear one.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, never tell you to one time. One time, you go listen to a big band, you see?
Yeah.
No, you see what kind of one. I want to be there. So, Duke Ellington, they come up all
a
palladium there, right? So, everybody in a building house, gone, you know, a fool, every listen to a building house, and I go. And we have one deputy roadmaster there, and I'm a fool, housemaster. And then David St. Elmo did doing in conference still on. Or then call it still on canoe. When I body speak, I went out of the world.
Mm.
I'm going to tell you, the man in common, he said, why are we not gone? But we know where I said, oh, we're a bad man. We're not gone. We're not listening to music there. You're still the one and thing we listen. You know? He said, go and get some culture. Go and listen to some different. And give you the money so we could get here and go in. So we have to go now, you know.
Eh.
I'm going to tell you, you know, man. And we go. Belgium, you know, so nobody knows how to come out there. I'm trying to see them, nobody knows how to look out at all I do. Hey, you never know if a man could have played drum so sweet in my deal to the man who played drum.
Yeah.
I went busy listening, playing up.
I tell you. I see you play already in the Central Park, man. I knew you out there. Busy listening today. Mr. Dizzy Gillis will play at Central Park and you know him turn up him on, him turn it up in the ear. The part where blow through. In the trumpet. Him turn it up in the ear and blow. May I tell you, you have a man Rasta.
When the man draw puff out like
I tell you.
But Mr. the man the news, but me say the drum soul up, you know man. You know, the man called Ongo Congo drum and then something there. You know, when sleep, you know, I took a drum and all that. You know, a man could have done a drum set to have them down there.
Yeah.
You understand me? And you know, it's nice, but the people forget. You feel listen different, you know what I mean? You feel listen to that kind of music and then your boy and then I mix your music nice.
Open your head cup, man. Can't just lie and appreciate our music. We have to move, though.
All right, man.
Yeah, man, listen. Yes, so without mentioning night food, we want to give thanks to the moment, you know. Give thanks to... All right, no. Sandra. No. What's your name again? Remind me again.
Sandre.
Sandre. Or Sandre. Stay here with me till 2 o'clock. I can't... Well, I know 2 yet. So I can't say 2 yet. But at the longest any so-called producer ever stay with me in this program, yeah? Well, I know you are not the longer because which name you used to stay? So, yeah. Who used to stay with me at night? And Brian used to stay till it done. Brian don't stay again, none at all, at 10 o'clock, so I'm gone. Neil used to stay with me, but him not stay, him not come back. So, very thank you very much. And your help for producing the thing, get the man and come back. That is very nice. Where the operator name again?
Shevani.
Who there? Who there?
Shevani.
Shevani, who there? Shevani, who there? Shevani, who you know, mama? Shevani, who are yellow vita too, who, as me say, no make me hungry at night time. Believe you me, and when me I go home, me, him no make me hungry at all. So give thanks. Give thanks. If the program not done yet, but remember the bridge and just mention night food a while ago. I want to pay night food, you know. Because them people are not, them people are you know. All the year them are going, but all them young people, you see. Them young people, I can't take them out. Look what I'm listening. You hear what I listen to? In a mentor business, I go and play some of them. Anyway, we can take this caller. Yes, heal.
Yes, Mota, blessing.
Come yeah, on, Harry.
Yeah. I need to call earlier, but you never hear me, you know?
Mm. Oh, yes. It's a mumble.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I said, I need to come check your arrival in St. Paul Sunday. I'll take a picture and thing, you know?
Oh, yeah? Wait, that's what people...
Yeah, man.
I mean, make you come long, eh?
Of course, man, absolutely.
You know, all who come up there, come for all who come for come see me without me shoes. When me look out, everybody put up their hand.
about 90% I thought come to see you, man. You know.
Shoes like that.
Yeah, man. It was a joy meeting you still. See, first graduation was nice, you know.
Yes, where you live? Where you live?
New York.
No, which part of New York?
Brooklyn.
Oh, yeah, they play from over Brooklyn, come over Queens.
Yeah, but you know what happened though? Right. Me play cricket, and me take it day off to yeah. Come watch you, because me go Jersey in the morning for your christening, yeah. Then come back a Queens to come see you, and take it day off from a game, you know?
Why you're busy, man.
Yeah, man, but you do that still, you know? Strength of motor.
All right, sir. All right, yeah, give thanks, Bridget, give thanks. Mm.
Yeah, man, blessing.
Yes. May I tell you, New York people, a long time we don't go to New York, though, you know. May I go back, they go to show, you know. May I go back, they go to show, because I'm not. Well, I truly not really interested in America again, panel levels. Because, you know, say, Lieutenant Teaching never perform. Because, let me say, him apply for him O-1 visa and him never get it quick. Ask him for this history of him things from 1980s and all them something there. That means ah, then the man will get no visa again, you know. By the time them don't ask you for your history of travel, from your start travel till now, I mean, and because one of the time them usually ask you for list all of the visa them, wherever get entry up to a certain period. The French embassy used to do that too, you know. The French embassy usually ask you for write down all the listings wherever. The last child travel. Now them ask for that tongue for listing that travel, but all of your email them. look at now, the enemy within, you know. If them things say the enemy will come from outside and go in there, they make a sad mistake. You know. All of the terrorist attack where them have already are people who grew up inside and all the man them will bring down the I saw Harry, we grew up in there and go to school and them something there. The one we go lick down this thing down in Florida the other day. The woman and the man, them have this party and they shoot up people and them thing there. And this is not a terrorist attack, but it's an enemy still shot A long time, you know, hear no big official get leaked in America, you know. Because America love kill them president, assassinate president, you know. They love do it. I want to hold the country and say, boy, if them not like them, do it. But you see the man say, the Republican Party is the Taliban in America. And you know what they mean? 66. 66. The man at 66, him come from Cleopatra, Illinois, come right down to Florida there. Not Florida, I wish for them to do again, Virginia, or Washington. Mm-hmm. For come lick two head. You know? None of them not dead still, but they must say one of them in a critical, the senator, look like him in a critical condition, but America no ramp. Can you hear them say that? Is it after that? Them send an email to a woman senator, one of the women, them, you know, where I say, one down, 216 to go. Yeah, and let them say that, the email said that. So they were trying to trace the email, you know. One down, 200 and leave to go. So it's like a war, them a rage, anti-Trump war. It look like the beginning of something, you know. It's a new thing, this, you know, like a beginning of a whole thing, you know. The man say, him not like Trump. Him not like anybody who follow him. So, him feel say them should have get rid of him and all of the people them around him. Fortunately, them kill him. Anyway, make way. Call that, all right, press it. Yes, EL. I think on the last call we're going to take more. Yes, EL.
EL, Muta?
Yeah, blessed man.
Yeah, I just phoned Bob Clark. He said that the dude hold me tight, the Johnny Nash, he said it was a argument he heard that took place in Trenchtown between Bob Marley and Marty Maplano. Yeah, it was an argument between Bob Marley and Martimo Plano, you know, and then Johnny Nash got the idea from that because he was there and witnessed the thing. And some time ago you did mention a tune from Studio One named Rainbow, and you was asking who was the artist. Is when he used to sing with Light Parks as the duo The Termites, the Studio One.
Yeah,
all right, so cool then.
Hold on, I could go back to the Johnny Nash show. So what Johnny Nash do is see a situation and then twist it into a woman, like, oh.
Into a woman, yeah, because as we know, when we hear that tune in at the 60s, round about 68, it is obvious that is a man and woman thing, because definitely you're not going to hear Bob Marley as about hold me tight and them thing there with Marty Maplano. Yes, and hold me tight, because Bob not depend on hold me tight with no man.
But not only that, no, because you have a tune name, I Shot the Sheriff, where it's not the sheriff you're talking about. You know what I'm saying? I Shot the Sheriff.
Yes, man, I Shot the Sheriff. Bring up and do over to.
Yeah.
What about it?
No, it's not a sheriff you matter about. I know sheriff you matter.
No. Yes, they must say it's not no sheriff you matter about. I mean, when I'm farmer girl friend that mentioned something else, you know what I mean?
Yeah. All right, Bridget, give thanks.
All right, blessed love.
Yes.